All right. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. I want to bid you all shalom. This is Dr. Yashua ben Ephraim coming at you all once again with another great video. And I hope you all are in great health and spirits as we continue to embark on this journey. Now, this is going to be that comprehensive video that I've told you all about. So I'm going to get right into the abstract and what you can expect. I tell you, it's action-packed, though. This video is the end-all, be-all. So let's get to it, all right? This is the abstract to prove my thesis, which is actually several. I have several points and several moving parts to my thesis. But it is now official. The genetic code / genetic mystery has finally been cracked, and you're hearing it here for the first time, coming from me, yours truly, Dr. Yashua ben Ephraim. My genetic research and findings all point to one logical conclusion about the origin and existence of the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype, and everything has culminated to this point right here. Now, in the last video, I reported how the African Lemba have already tested positive for possessing the Cohen modal haplotype, which genetically proves that they are direct descendants from the tribe of Levi, the priestly tribe of Aaron, brother of Moses. And although the quote-unquote powers that be have tried to pitch to us that the Lemba are from haplogroup J, which is a European haplogroup that originated in the Caucasus Mountains as a so-called contributor of their Cohen modal, at least that's what they're trying to imply. I already exposed that last segment or last video as a blatant and total lie, because those groups in haplogroup J, who they claim are descendants of Cohens, have very little or no actual Cohen blood at all. And I already presented the DNA proof that the African Lemba has more Cohen blood in them than the Ashkenazis and the Sephardic Jews put together. So basically they prove their own selves to be liars. And haplogroup J is not the contributor to the Lemba's Cohen modal haplotype. And although they try to keep their real Y DNA haplotype hidden or under tight wraps, my suspicions were confirmed. The African Lemba are of the Negro haplotype E1B1A, as are we, the so-called African Americans, the Bantus of West Africa, and other Negroes scattered throughout the four corners of the world, in Haiti, the West Indies, and several groups throughout the Caribbean that have a percentage of Negro Hebrew blood, etc. And if they are E1B1A and have proven to be Cohens from the tribe of Levi, then that means Levi, one of Jacob's 12 sons, possessed the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype as well. And if Levi possessed the E1B1A, well, he got it from his father. So that means that Jacob possessed the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype as well. So it goes without saying, clearly, this means that Abraham, whom the Most High said he was going to make the father of many nations, possessed the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype as well. So with all that said, the only logical conclusion is that the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype and all of its subgroups are actually the founding lineage of the ancient Israelite nation. And this has been kept hidden in a secret, not just from us, but the world. The so-called powers that be continue to do their best to keep this historical, scriptural, and genetic fact from all the rightful children of Israel who are scattered in America, abroad, and all around the world. The Negro Y DNA haplogroup of E1B1A is the founding lineage of Israel. Jacob passed on the Negro Y DNA haplotype to all 12 of his Negro sons, whom their mothers were Negro women, who became the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, I've taught ad nauseum that a male child automatically takes on his father's Y DNA and bloodline the minute he's conceived. And there's no disputing this genetically, scientifically, or scripturally. All 12 sons of Jacob possessed his Y DNA haplotype of E1B1A and passed it on to all the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel who are walking around throughout the four corners of the earth today, more commonly referred to as Negroes or so-called African Americans here in America. Now listen to me clearly, and this clears up any and all misgivings, misconceptions, misunderstandings, whatever. If you are not of the Negro E1B1A haplogroup or any of its subgroups, you are not a Hebrew Israelite by blood lineage and therefore cannot establish genealogy as a child of Israel. Let me repeat that. If you are not of the Negro E1B1A haplogroup or any of its subgroups, you are not a Hebrew Israelite by blood lineage and therefore cannot establish genealogy as a child of Israel. Now again, I'm not interested in fabricated or skewed facts and logic or bastardizations of scripture. I don't got time for all that. My DNA research, along with revelation to me by grace and mercy of the Most High, has finally tied everything together as a people and as a nation. As I promised beforehand, this video presentation is the first of its kind, and it's extremely comprehensive. I leave no stone unturned. It meets each lie head on and destroys it with genetic and scientific fact and proof. Plus, it ties everything and everyone together. So there is no doubt, no question, and no dispute as to who the Hebrew Israelites really are, who they aren't, and who the descendants are in the earth today. As such, I have found no scientific DNA or genetic evidence or proof that backs the Ethiopians' claim of being descended from King Solomon by way of Queen of Sheba and bearing a son by the name of Menelik. Now, this long-held story were true, the DNA evidence would be overwhelming, meaning there would be a mountain of Ethiopians who carry the E1B1A haplotype or one of its subgroups. And I have found no such proof. Now, the small percentage of Ethiopians that do possess the E1B1A haplotype is actually more suggestive of a few Hebrews throughout history who laid seed with Ethiopian women. I mean, no more or less. And the small percentage proves that. The only thing it is indicative of is of a few males of Hebrew stock who had children with some women in that group. And then the males obviously grew up in around the mother's people and identify as Ethiopian. Now, no other scientific or genetic proof exists to the contrary. I've said this many times over and over again, and I will continue to say it. It doesn't matter what you believe or what you've been told or taught your entire life. DNA takes the guesswork out of everything, and it reveals the truth. It lifts the skirt of the liars, the culture stealers, and oppressors. King Solomon King Solomon was from the tribe of Judah, which means he genetically carried the E1B1A and would have passed that Y DNA bloodline on to a supposed son. Now, if this belief and story were true, there would be a plethora of Ethiopians running around with this Y DNA haplotype. And I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news, but this myth does not hold up under scientific or genetic DNA scrutiny. It just doesn't. I've looked high and low, trust me. And I can find no corroborative evidence of this. Now, if someone has any legit and concrete DNA proof of this long-held Ethiopian and Rastafarian belief, I'm definitely all ears and willing to listen. You know, other than that, we can kill that and move on. All right? They're not us. As much as they like to claim that they are or think that they are, I mean, they truthfully do not like us, never have, just like many of those other African group and Canaanite groups, just like the Arabs and the rest of them. They've always been jealous of us in our position as a true house of Israel. Don't get it twisted. The Assyrian king, Shalmaneser, he replaced many of the original Hebrews with the Ethiopians in Israel, but they are no different than any of those other invader or rebel groups that polluted our holy city of Jerusalem with their Gentile blood. Now, with this presentation, I'm going to show and prove that the E1B1A haplogroup is the founding lineage of Israel, that so-called African Americans, majority of, are descended from Igbo and Yoruban Jews that scriptures say would go back into slavery by way of ships in Deuteronomy 28 and 68. I'm going to show and prove that the E1B1A Negro or so-called African Americans are not from the bloodline of Ham. And our Y DNA haplotype of E1B1A did not originate in East, West, North, or South Africa. I'm going to show and prove that the Y DNA haplotype of Ham's bloodline is E1B1B. So there's no way Negroes can be of Ham, because our DNA is clearly E1B1A. It's really as simple as that, people. But I'm going to bring that forth. I'm going to lay out what happened to our DNA, just like I told you all, out of Israel, why it points mostly to West Africa now. The Bantu expansion was actually primarily a Hebrew expansion, because the Bantus are Negroes, they're Hebrews. And they either started civilizations over in West Africa, or they mixed in with some local West African tribes, or what they call in genetics, they admixed in with some of the local West Africans. Now, the Bamileke appear to be one of those tribes in West Africa that are 100% all Hebrew in stock. Okay? I'm going to show and prove that the original Hebrew Israelites were a Negro people and dark-skinned. Not dark-skinned Arab or Middle Eastern looking, as some tried to proclaim. They may have looked Africanic by their features externally, or what some would call sub-Saharan, but make no mistake, the original Hebrew Israelites were dark-skinned, black, Negro people, and not the same people as Africans or Canaanites, period, point blank. But because of us being scattered throughout the world, the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel, who are all Negro, will be all different shades of black today. But please don't get it twisted. If they carry the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype or any of its subgroups, they are Hebrew Israelite by blood and thereby children of Israel. There's so much information contained in this presentation. I honestly didn't know where to begin exactly, but I can tell you, whatever question I didn't answer in the last couple videos will definitely be answered here. I wanted to kind of start with in the beginning, so to speak, and, you know, speak about what happened to us, you know, but I'll probably have to work my way back. But trust, we'll get there. And just like the last time, get you something to write with, grab a King James Version Bible, older one preferably, because the newer ones have taken the word black out. Yeah, they went there. They've taken the word black out. But let's get into it. All that being said, let's start this historical revelation and presentation. The E1B1A is the founding lineage for the ancient Israelite nation. And I bid everybody shalom. All right, and just like that, we are off and running. I'm going to start here because of many of you, if you remember, when I put out the very first DNA video, and I said then it was like a precursor of sorts, because it gave a very brief yet concise description of what Y-DNA was and how it operated in terms of the male child getting it from the father and establishing the bloodline from conception. And that's how patrilineal lineage works. You have to go through the father. All this establishing, you know, lineage to the mother, that's nonsense, man. That's some satanic type, you know, whole other gender type thing that's not sanctioned by the Torah at all. So that tells you right there that the people doing that are not operating in line with the Most High, because that goes directly against the Torah. Your lineage is established through the male, through the father, period, point blank. So I discussed that in the very first video, and I gave a really, really good overview of how DNA works, right? So upon my research, you know, when I came upon Family Tree DNA, like I said, they were one of the few companies that actually placed our Y-DNA of E1B1A at the start of the Israelite nation, right? But at the same time, some things about it always kind of troubled me, and it was almost like, you know, it was saying that, okay, yes, you know, your haplogroup or your DNA was in Israel, but you're predominantly Sub-Saharan African. Let's read it. Let me break it down, and then I'll go into the next segment of what this, or rather the significance of this, because this was actually listed as a quote unquote Jewish haplogroup, right? Okay, cool. So now it says this haplogroup is predominantly Sub-Saharan African and is the most common haplogroup among African Americans. Then it goes on to say among Jews, it can be found in very small percentages, even in Jews from Eastern Europe, where there's little, if any, African influence to be found. Now, here's the kicker. It said this indicates that while this haplogroup is certainly not a founding lineage for Jews, it was present in very small amounts at the time and formation of the ancient Israelite nation. Now, that never sit well with me, because I'm thinking, okay, if basically you're using wording to say that our DNA was there in Israel, but it was in very small amounts, why would you go as far as to say that the haplogroup is certainly not a founding lineage for Jews? I thought that was really peculiar. Like, you know, if you really didn't believe that, or you know, or there was no evidence to the contrary, it would be pointless to even make a statement like that. So that was the first red flag to me. Okay, they wanted to kind of hammer home, it seems like, that this, the haplogroup, is so-called Sub-Saharan African. And let me just state for the record, you know, not to get too far ahead of the presentation, but the E1B1A, it points predominantly West African now, because that's where we in the haplogroup migrated to. And ironically, it's this, for the same reason why a lot of those European haplogroups are pointing to the Middle East. That's not where they originated. Okay? That's where they invaded. That's where their people who raped the land, who stole the land, you know, back in those times, whatever the case may be, their DNA convicts them of that. So that's why our DNA points mostly to West Africa, or what they call Sub-Saharan. But haplogroup E1B1A is not Sub-Saharan. So anyway, not to go on a tangent, but so it made me think, okay, why would a company as big as Family Tree DNA, and I have to give them credit, they have one of the biggest database, DNA databases in the world. Why would a company as big as that make statements to the effect of, and they have to know the truth, right? So it made me question who was actually behind Family Tree DNA, right? So this leads to the next segment. Pause. And this person, ladies and gentlemen, is the president, CEO, and founder of Family Tree DNA, Mr. Bennett Greenspan, an Ashkenazi Jew. Now, you know, I'm not one to jump on, you know, conspiracy theories, you know, Illuminati, all this kind of stuff. But at the same time, I'm a realist. At the same time, I know who scripture says are the people who've conspired to keep us and our identity hidden. Now, you know, for what it's worth, you know, it seems that, you know, he was trying to somewhat, you know, tell the truth, but at the same time, still perpetuating the lie, right? You know, in essence, giving us a shout out saying, hey, and basically giving us like a little wink, wink, like, yeah, you guys are sub-Saharan African, but I know you started in Israel. Here's your little shout out, wink, wink. Well, that's a misnomer. African and Israel are two totally different things. But anyway, so when I found out who was actually behind Family Tree DNA and who this man is, you know, then it made more sense as to the wording. Like I said, it seems like he was kind of push-pulling with it. You know, I don't know who's backing him. I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, well, you know, he's got the rich Zionist Jews behind him and da 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 da. I really don't know. I'm not even going to go that far. But I just know that you have to know, to understand, rather, when someone's pitching something to you as fact, you have to know about the person who's pitching it. That's exactly why I did my personal DNA journey, so you could all know who I am. That's important. To know the author of the person who's trying to shape your opinion and views about something, okay? Like, what's their agenda? What's their point? What do they get from it? You know, that, you know, answer those kind of questions. So, yeah, Bennett Greenspan. Now, all that being said, you know, even when I found out who was actually behind Family Tree DNA, and then everything kind of became more focused, everything was okay until I came upon this particular article. And then everything changed in terms of my view of this man, Mr. Bennett Greenspan and Family Tree DNA. And here is the article that changed everything about my view of Mr. Greenspan, questioning his motives, his intentions, and his credibility, and you know, his intent, man, his position. You know, bottom line, you know, in the one recurring theme, whether it's in the Torah or in the Quran, is to mix up the truth with falsehood. You know, clearly with this article, he's with the businessman. He's an Ashkenazi sympathizer, and he's continuing to perpetuate this myth and these enormous lies about the Ashkenazi Jews that occupy Israel today and that have been occupying Israel since 1948 originated in the Middle East. And I mean, this is an intelligent man with one of the biggest DNA companies in the world. You have to know that when he lays down at night, that he knows this is not the truth. But I'm going to read this article, all right? And then we're going to go into some other prominent Jewish scholars and authors who directly refute Mr. Greenspan and say, listen, the Ashkenazi Jews are European. They're not Hebrews, man. They are Jewish. Okay? Like everyone doesn't know that the majority of them moved to Israel in 1948, man. You know, like we don't know that. And he's continuing to perpetuate this lie and this myth. Well, let's read it. This is what did it for me, man. This brought everything into focus about this man and his little shout out, and still trying to, keep our identity hitting. And I know he knows the truth. And 5% ideology, he would be considered a 10%er because he knows the truth and he's keeping it hidden from our people and everyone else. Okay, it says the founder and president of Family Tree DNA, one of the top U.S. genealogical genetic testing companies, said genetics prove that the Jewish people's ancestors originated in the Middle East. Now, my people, truthfully, after I read that, I could have stopped reading, man. I mean, seriously, this is past pathetic. And this is why and how power, money, and control is used to keep voices like mine hidden, to keep the truth hidden from the masses. And, Bill Cosby said it best, man, he who controls the media controls the world. And this isn't no race baiting type thing. It's the facts, man. All right. Zionist Jews control most of the media, the banking systems, you name it. They are very rich and very powerful. They have the money, they have the influence to continue to espouse false information like this. Jewish people's ancestors originated in the Middle East, really? And you put that out with a straight face? But let's read on. Let's read on. And it goes on to say, quote, "We're not interlopers who came here from Eastern Europe." Now that's funny. "And we're not Serbs or Khazars," Bennett Greenspan said during a guest lecture on Wednesday at the Netanyahu or the Netanya Academic College in Israel. That is hilarious, man. This man actually, oh, wow. Greenspan refuted the idea stipulated in a book written by Tel Aviv University historian Shlomo San that modern Jews are not descendants of people who migrated from the Middle East, but of people who lived elsewhere and converted to Judaism. Yet another study published in 2012 by Harry Osterer, a medical geneticist from the Albert Einstein College of Medicine, showed that many Jews today do have distinctive genetic traits that can be pinpointed back to the Middle East. You can use whatever polemic you want to discredit the Jews or discredit the nation, but saying that we weren't here is a lie, Greenspan said. Wow, isn't that ironic? A lie. Imagine that. Among, quote, no less than 75% of Ashkenazi, Sephardi, or Mizrahi Jews, their ancestors came from what we call the general Middle East based on family tree DNA database data. So my people, with that, any benefit of the doubt, I tried to give this man. When I came upon this article, that did it for me. He tells you straight up who he is, what he's about, and he's going to continue to try to perpetuate the lie and myth that the Ashkenazi Jews that occupy Israel today originated there or originated in the Middle East. So you have to take that with a grain of salt in terms of, this man is not credible when it comes to Hebrew Israelite lineage and getting the bloodline established, right? So, he's going to continue to perpetuate this great, humongous lie, man, all right? Like, we don't know that they moved there in 1948 and they didn't originate in Israel. I mean, come on, really? There's too many books out there. There's too much science, too much genetic evidence to the contrary. And this is past pathetic. I mean, it's not even funny how blatantly dishonest, man, these people are and will continue to go, great lengths to hang on to these recycled and regurgitated lies. Even after their own people have repeatedly come out with books and genetic facts stating emphatically that the people who occupy Israel today and have been since 1948 are not the original inhabitants of that land, man. And they're actually Khazar. in stock, i.e. Europeans, mostly from the Caucasus Mountains. So in the next segment, we're gonna go into Shlomo Sand. I'm gonna talk about him a little bit. Like I said, he's a professor at Tel Aviv. His book, The Invention of the Jewish People, was on the bestsellers list in Israel for many, many weeks. And we'll talk about and discuss briefly Arthur Koestler, his book, The 13th Tribe. So, you know, it's just way too much information out there. And from their own people, man, that says, look, man, this is a lie. This is a myth. Okay? But they still want to continue to perpetuate the lies. So let's move on to the next segment and talk a little bit about Shlomo Sand and the 13th Tribe. And then we can sort of, you know, move on from there. I'm not going to just, you know, beat this into the ground. It is what it is. And this is Mr. Shlomo Sand, professor and historian at the Tel Aviv University in Israel. He's the author of that book, The Invention of the Jewish People. And you can see a little bit of his biography. It says he was born in Austria to Polish Jewish survivors of the Holocaust. Sidebar, the actual first president of Israel was actually Polish and from Poland. And he actually changed his name. He had a Polish surname. He changed his name to sound more quote unquote Jewish because he was from Poland. Just a little sidebar, a little tidbit right there. And here's some of Mr. Sand's views. And, you know, clearly he's not with the business. You know, he's not with that Ashkenazi or Zionist agenda, you know, and you have to applaud him for that. You know, I don't care what your nationality is, your race is, your color, whatever. When you take a stand for the truth, to me, that's to be applauded. Because 9 times out of 10, the truth is going to always be unpopular. For some reason, people have a problem with the truth. And I mean, that's even prevalent among my people who refuse to believe who they are. I mean, all this proof in their face, all the genetics, the DNA, the Bible, the scripture. And people have human nature, man. Problem with the truth, but not to go on a tangent. It says, this is Mr. Sand's view, some of his views. I'm not gonna read all of it, but I'll just read some of the highlights. He says, while acknowledging the affinity between Jews and the Holy Land, Sand has said that, quote, I don't think the religious affinity to the land gives you historical right. Right on. Still, he supports Israel's existence, not because of historical right, but because of the fact that it exists today, and any effort to destroy it will bring new tragedies. I have to totally agree with that. I mean, that's just real. And then go down a little bit, he says, comparing the Palestinians to children of rape, Sand has said that Israel, quote, raped a population, and not only a population, we destroyed the society. Man, I'm gonna end that. You know, you guys can kind of pause that and read it, but we got a long way to go. So we're gonna go into the next segment of Mr. Sand, and then move on to Mr. Koestler and then go on from there. All right, now this next segment is entitled Criticism of Gene Studies. excuse me. It says, in 2010, when Harry Oster, a Jewish professor of genetics at the Albert Einstein College of Medicine, and we mentioned him some slides ago, announced the results of a DNA study showing, quote, powerful genetic markers of Jewish ancestry, end quote. Sand told Science magazine that, quote, Hitler would certainly have been very pleased, end quote. Writing in the Chronicle of Higher Education, Josh Fishman noted that Sand's argument in The Invention of the Jews, quote, the Jews arose from converting many local communities in Europe and elsewhere, is contradicted by Oster's work, which shows that geographically and culturally, distant Jews still have more genes in common than they do with non-Jews around them, and that those genes can be traced back to the Levant in an area including modern day Israel, end quote. Oster, end quote. Oster was offended by Sand's attack, quote, bringing up Hitler was overheated and misconstrues my work, end quote. Huh, you don't say. But Sand reiterated his criticism, writing in an email to Fishman that, quote, It is a shame for somebody who defines himself as a Jew to look for a Jewish gene. And again, you know, you have to applaud that, because he's not having none of that, and he's not backing down. All right. So kudos to Mr. San on that. I think what's kind of fascinating to me is that he's a prominent, you know, Jewish historian and professor, and he's, you know, really adamant in his position that, you know, the Jewish people were basically invented. His book, The Invention of the Jewish People, we read a little bit about it right here. It says San's best known book in English is The Invention of the Jewish People, originally published in Hebrew. Come down a little bit. It says the book was in the bestseller list in Israel for 19 weeks. It was reprinted 3 weeks from published in French, yada, yada, yada. So, and they said up to the top, it has generated a heated controversy. Of course it's going to be heated. It's going to be controversial because it goes against the status quo. It goes against the, he's not with the business, man. He's like, listen, this is not true. This is a myth. And he's not going to help perpetuate or take part in that lie. And again, we're done with Mr. Sand, but, I got to give him props and shout outs for, trying to take a stand for the truth. Got to respect that, man.
Now, let me just reveal some things. First of all, is that the Jews who were brought in Israel, most of them are white. Not most of them, almost all of them are white, including me. I was brought in Israel from a country which is called Bulgaria. It's a European country. And I can tell you that in every European country, there are Jews, and there is so-called organization, Jewish Agency, which is trying to take those Jews to Israel. If you track the this organization, you can find out that this is not an Israeli organization. This is an American organization. Jewish Agency is an American organization which has the exclusive right to decide who is Jewish and who is not on this planet, and who to be taken to Israel and who's not. Now, if you do research, you will find out that in Africa, in Black Africa, they're looking for Jews only in Ethiopia. They bring Jews only from Ethiopia. And I can tell you, by knowing a lot of people, Ethiopian Jews here in Israel, that they're treated very badly, very badly. And many of them commit suicide because they cannot take it. So they come from some place, Ethiopia, they don't have much there, but they live decent life. And they, when they come here and try to be humiliated and so on, some of them cannot even take it. Now, what I'm trying to say is that why from each white country this Jewish agency is trying to bring Jews, and when it's about Black Africa, they're going to Ethiopia, and this is where they stop. The only one place. Now, because of the same thing, they're trying to do the white supremacy here. They try to bring white guys here and to take the supremacy over Arabs, which are the local citizens, and over Blacks, which are, so far, they're only the Ethiopian Jews. Now, what I'm trying also to say is that another question is why? Why America needs Israel? There is no oil like in other Middle Eastern countries. There's no nothing they can be attracted to. But why do they do all these things? Why do they invest money, bring white people and so on, when they build their system of white supremacy, just like in America, they build in Israel? Why? And I can tell you why. Because the true Jews, according to the Bible, you can check it in the Bible, you can read Job 30:30 and some other places, they have never been white. They have been people of color. And they have not stopped in Ethiopia. They were in Ethiopia, Sudan, and they have settled in West Africa. From West Africa, they have been taken as slaves to America. Brothers and sisters, Blacks of America, it's you. You are the true Hebrews. You are the true Hebrews from the Bible. America gonna do everything, gonna invest as much money as it has, gonna fight as much wars as they can, gonna invite as much weapons as they can just to hide this away from you. Gonna take Israel, gonna bring white people here and to tell you these are the Jews, gonna kill you, gonna kill Arabs, gonna mistreat white people like this guy, just to tell you this lie, that you are nobody and we are the Jews with all the history and so on. It has been deleted, your history. You don't know who you are. Don't forget about it. This is why America has been taking your history away, never to find out that it's all about you. I'm telling you this, please. I don't ask you to come to Israel and to start a revolution. I'm just asking you to start thinking this way, to believe me a little bit, because I'm living in Israel and I'm part of this injustice. I really believe that people like me and you, we can bring the justice back. Thank you.
Wow. emotional indeed, man. I included that testimony because not only was it powerful, and he's one of many, you know, this man is, he's by his own admission, he's a European Ashkenazi Jew living in Israel. And he's taking the time to say, hey, listen, black people in America, you are the quote unquote true Jews. It's you. Not only that, but I wanted you to also see that if you listen to everything this man said, he's telling you that America or these American agencies, they're with the business, man. They know the truth and they know what they're doing. So just, you know, you can read between the lines, but just really, really listen to that testimony, man. I had to include that into this presentation because it was very relevant. I'm sure emotional for a lot of you and powerful at the same time. So we're going to go ahead and round out, you know, Mr. Bennett Greenspan and end this segment on this Hebrew/Jewish DNA haplogroup and then move on, to the next segment. But again, shout out to the gentleman in that video and anyone of whatever ethnic background you are who is willing to take a stand, you know, for the truth. Well, Mr. Bennett Greenspan, here we are. You said that haplogroup E1B1A was sub-Saharan, and we know that is a lie, and you do as well. You said that the E1B1A is actually found in Eastern Europe where there's no Africans. Well, that should tell you that it's not an African haplogroup. You know, you continue to contradict yourself and basically make yourself out to be a liar. But, either way, and you also said that our DNA was, the E1B1A was found in very small amounts. That also is a lie. And you made it a point to try to say that that our haplogroup, the E1B1A, is certainly not a founding lineage for Jews. Well, that is the biggest lie that you've told, because not only was our DNA present, the E1B1A, but the E1B1A, Mr. Bennett, is actually the founding lineage for the Jews, or for the ancient Israelite nation, I'm sorry. So we reject that, which you put out there as a so-called fact and truth, and we submit a more factual and truthful Y DNA haplogroup of the E1B1A. And here it is. Here's the truth, Israel, and we can replace that BS with the real knowledge of the haplogroup E1B1A and its origins and where it came from. Okay. Haplogroup E1B1A is a Hebrew Israelite haplogroup. Okay, this haplogroup is found predominantly among Bantu Negro descendants, to include but not limited to the African Lemba, many West African tribes, Igbo Jews, Yoruba Jews, African Americans, West Indians, Brazilians, Haitians, and other Negro influenced races throughout the Caribbean and scattered across all different nations. Contrary to false DNA reporting, this is not a sub-Saharan or Hamitic haplogroup. It is Semitic in origin. Negroes have been identified as being exempt from the bloodline of Ham as per the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary. This haplogroup represents the Y DNA of Jacob, the father of the 12 tribes of Israel, Dr. Yahshua ben Ephraim. And this is a segue into our next segment. All right, now this is probably the foundation of one of the biggest lies about our people. This actually probably sets everything in motion as far as so-called the blacks being the quote-unquote curse of Ham. And actually that whole curse of Ham stuff originated from the Jews, actually. And you could find that in their satanic Babylonian Talmud, that blacks are a result of the curse of Ham, which is a blatant lie, you know, like so many others. Get in line, right? But that's where that whole curse of Ham thing came from. You can find that in the Babylonian Talmud, which is a satanic book, and they already were outed as the synagogue of Satan. But you know, I'm not going to go on a tangent. We're going to deal with this right here. So it says Ham, the youngest son of Noah, born probably about 96 years before the flood, and one of eight persons to live through the flood, he became the progenitor of the dark races, not the Negroes, but the Egyptians, Ethiopians, Libyans, and Canaanites, or Africans. And that is in the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary as reference. Now, if you're like me, when I first began on this journey of discovering this truth, that really stood out to me. Not the Negroes, but it didn't give any other information. Okay, not the Negroes. So that would be the so-called African Americans. They're saying that we're not of Ham. So then, who are we from, or where are we from, and what do they mean, not the Negroes? So anyway, let's fast forward a little bit. That term Negroes was actually defined a totally different way many years ago, before they did away with the definition of Negroes. Now pause that and frame that real quick. Now remember how they always say, well they always try to tell us, oh, you black people, you're from the Bantu expansion, West Africa, yada yada yada. Well, guess what? Thank you, white people. You've been telling us that for years. But what you didn't tell us, and what you probably didn't even know, is that the Bantus are actually Hebrew Israelites. Now, pause that. Now, let's go back to not the Negroes. Now, I'm gonna add this little piece, so the definition of Negroes can be defined of how it was defined many years ago before they changed it and took it out. Now, if they had never taken out the original definition of Negroes, we would have known that the Bantus were considered Negroes, and that we would have put two and two together. Wait a minute, Bantus, Negroes, black people from Bantus. Oh man, wait a minute. So okay, so we're part of that whole Negro thing. So when the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary says not the Negroes, it's saying basically not the Bantus and not the people of that Bantu expansion. So I guess they didn't think, or that we would be able to read one day, or we would want to find out the information or find out the truth. So they said, oh no, they're getting too close. We got to do away with that. So let me just pause that. I'm going to include this definition of not the Negroes, or I'm going to include the definition of what Negroes originally stated, and then we'll get back on this segment.
Here it says Negro, plural Negroes, Spanish Negro, from, right, Negro, black, from Latin Niger, like this, we get Niger, Nigeria, Niger. It says a person of the typical African branch of the black race. They don't talk like this anymore. It was too telling. They never thought that our people would read and study and seek the truth about who they are. So when we started to read these things and find out and use as proof, This is where they had to, you know, upgrade what they were saying to try to confuse folks who are not going to study and find out the roots. It says, formerly called the Ethiopian. Let's read the sentence again. It says, a person of the typical African branch of the black race, formerly called the Ethiopian. So before they were called the black race, what were they called? The Ethiopian, inhabiting the Sudan, or loosely, right, or, let's see, or loosely of any of the black races of Africa, including besides the Negroes, proper Bantus, that Bantu word, Pygmies, Hottentot, and Bushmen. Maybe that's the reason why they have the clicks too. See language table. Secondary is a black man, a person having more or less Negro blood, more or less. Look at Negroid. Negroid, characteristic of or like the Negro or Negroes, a member of a race perceptibly sharing Negro blood, that means, you know, looking black, or displaying Negro traits, especially a Bantu.
So there you have it, Bantus. Had they never changed or taken out the definition of Negroes, we would have known that when the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary said that Ham became the progenitor of the dark races, but not the Negroes, we'd have made, put two and two together, and we'd be like, wow, so the Negroes are of Shem. They're not of Ham, like the lies have been told, right? And we would have put that together. So they had it, they took it out, man. They're like, oh no, we gotta get rid of this. You know, they're on us. You know, they can read now. You know? But yeah, that was profound. You know, that was definitely profound. So yes, the Bantus are Hebrews. So when they try to say, yeah, oh yeah, you're from the Bantu expansion. Yeah, yeah, yep, you're right. We are. Yep. And how we know the Bantus are Hebrews as well is because their blood and DNA, which is the same as ours, E1B1A, is not found pretty much anywhere else. It trails off in East Africa and North Africa. Right? And I kind of deal with that a little bit later too, in terms of debunking the fact that the Y DNA of E1B1A originated in North or East Africa, which is, you know, it's a bunch of crap, cockamamie BS, man. But yeah, so let's see if this Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary passage holds up to scientific, genetic, and DNA scrutiny. So it says, Negroes are not of Ham. So that means that our bloodline should not match Egyptians, Ethiopians, Libyans, or Africans, right? Right. Well, let's see if that holds up to scientific and genetic scrutiny. All right, here we go. Now let's get to it. Now the EM35 or the E1B1B. I wanted to show this real quick because I want everyone to see and know that I'm not trying anything funny. I want to be totally transparent and totally forthcoming, you know, with this information, especially from a scientific and genetic standpoint. Okay, let's read about it real quick before I actually provide the DNA evidence of those groups that said Ham became the progenitor of. All right, this is the precursor. It says, for people who have tested and been assigned paternal haplogroup Y, DNA haplogroup E1B1B, or EM35, or are believed to have had this haplogroup based on descendants tested, defining mutations, M35. Okay, origin. The modern population of EM215 and EM35 lineages are almost identical. Yep. They really are. And therefore, by definition, age estimates based on these two populations are also identical. E1B1B or EM215, which is a subgroup, and its dominant subclade, E1B1B1, EM35, are believed to have first appeared in East Africa about 22,400 years ago. So let's pause that real quick, and not to go on a tangent, but this is the DNA that originated in East Africa, not ours. Okay, they got us twisted with somebody else. This is E1B1B or EM35 that originated in East Africa. And as we go down, we'll see Northern Africa, but not us. Y'all, they got us twisted, man. Let's read on. Distribution, the M215 is distributed as far south as South Africa and northwards into North Africa. You see, my people, see, we're putting it all together. Now it's becoming more in focus. From where it has in more recent millennia expanded to Europe and Asia, M35 is the predominant subclade of E1B1B, representing almost exactly the same population. Now check this out. A significant proportion of Jewish male lineages are M35. M35, which accounts for approximately 18 to 20% of Ashkenazi and 8.6% to 30% of Sephardi Y chromosomes, appears to be one of the major founding lineages of the Jewish population. That is funny, because the people that have this lineage or this bloodline, man, you'll see, man, they're Africans. They are Africans. So for them to attach themselves to the E1B1B and pretty much, you know, kind of disassociate themselves with the E1B1A, that's backwards. Because E1B1B are Hamites, Hamitic, and I'm about to prove that right now. This is, oh my God, this is funny, man. This is so, it's funny and it's fun, because I'm proving genetically, man, that these people have it twisted. They're trying to call us up, trying to diss us, talking about E1B1A is sub-Saharan African. No, E1B1B is sub-Saharan African, you know? Yeah, let's get into it. I wanted to kind of to let you all see that, though, because that M35, remember that, that EM35 or that E1B1B, that is the Y DNA of those groups that the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary says Ham became the progenitors of. And I'm going to show and prove, I'm going to show that DNA right now as we continue to move forward in the segment. All right. Now, this is the DNA data of the dark races that the Compact Bible speaks of, that Ham became the progenitor of. Now, I don't want you to get confused with all the different numbers, percentages, and nomenclatures. That's why I'm here to quarterback it with all this DNA stuff. But if you see the column that says sample, we're going to count over four. One, two, three, four to M35, the EM35, E1B1B. That's what the M35 means, and that's where our focus is. Now, the M215, the M28, those are all just subgroups or subclades of the same group, basically. So we're not focusing on that. Our focus is the main haplogroup of these races, which is the M35. That's the umbrella, if you will. Okay, so we're going to keep our focus there. So just remember that it's four columns over, EM35, and we're going to identify those dark races by their Y DNA that the Compact Bible speaks of. So the next slide, four columns over, EM35. Let's get it. Well, remember, four columns over. One, two, three, four, boom. That's the EM35 of the E1B1B. Now actually this slide is the end all be all, because this slide includes all the dark races that the Compact Bible Dictionary speaks of that Ham became the progenitors of. It said he became the progenitor of the dark races, not the Negroes, but the Egyptians, Ethiopians, Libyans, and Canaanites or Africans. And as you can see, my people, all those groups are listed right here. Boom, EM35 or E1B1B. You start from the top, you see the Algerians, see the Ethiopians, you see all manner and like manners of the Ethiopians fall under the E1B1B or the EM35. Scroll down, you see the Libyans, right? See the Egyptians. And you come down, you see the Maasai, which is a African or Canaanite group. Now, keep in mind, there's plenty of Hamites and Africans and, you know, that fall under the EM35. This is nowhere near an exhaustive or comprehensive list of Hamitic groups. But just to prove my point, scientifically and genetically, right here, we are looking at genetic proof that the E1B1B or the EM35 is actually the Hamitic bloodline and the bloodline of Ham. So when it said not the Negroes, that proves it right there. It's in their face, man. We have the genetic scientific proof right here in front of us. We're looking at it together. Okay, so I'm establishing the genetic haplogroup of the Hamitic bloodline. And obviously it's E1B1B or EM35 or any one of those subgroups that fall under there. There you go. So with that said, let us continue. Okay, I wanted to kind of add this as an addendum of sorts to the EM35 or the E1B1B designation for the Ham bloodline, just so you all can kind of see. Haplogroup EM215, like I said a few slides ago, that's a subgroup of the EM35, right? Possible time, approximately 22,400 years, yada, yada. Now, North Africa, that's key, North Africa. Now, their ancestor, who's their ancestor? EP2, descendants. Again, see that haplogroup EM35 and EM281. Again, all subgroups of the EM35. Now, just so you're, in case you're wondering, well, who's the EP2? I know all these little small nomenclatures are can be kind of confusing, but just, I got you. Who's the EP2? Well, let's see. Haplogroup EP2. Who are they? In human population genetics, haplogroups define the major lineages of direct paternal male lines back to a shared common ancestor in Africa. EP2 is the most dominant Y chromosome lineage in Africa and exists at lower frequencies in the Middle East. Let me say that one more time. And exists at lower frequencies in the Middle East and Europe. The lineage is thought to have originated in or near modern day Ethiopia. Boom. There you go, my peoples. I brought it all back full circle. Okay. E1B1B, the EM35 that the Ethiopians belong to, the Libyans, the Africans, and the Egyptians is a Hamitic bloodline. And I just brought it back full circle. Show and prove, man. Show and prove. And I did just that. So we're going to go on to the EM2 or the E1B1A, which is the bloodline of the Negroes and Shem's bloodline. So we now know that Ham's bloodline is E1B1B, and there's no disputing that genetically or scientifically. How about that? All right, before I bring out the Negro or the E1B1A Shem's bloodline, I kind of wanted to include this segment because I thought it was very interesting. President Obama, because I often wondered, is he, Hebrew, I know his father's from Kenya and everything, and no, he's not. The president is from the bloodline of Ham. He's literally from an African tribe. His father is from the Luau tribe. And I thought it would be interesting to kind of do a little research on the Luau tribe and kind of just get a glimpse at what a Hamitic Canaanite or African tribe actually looks like. And you'll be kind of amused to see what I found. But remember, he has no genetic ties with us whatsoever. And here you go. Oh, man, when I saw these pictures, man, this is the Luau tribe. And these are supposed to be men of the Luau tribe. I thought about the Most High admonishing us not to do what the Africans and the Egyptians do, because A lot of those Canaanite groups, man, those African groups, they were heavy into homosexuality, man. We were admonished not to do as they do. And those dudes look mad suspect, man. They do. They look real suspect. These guys give them a little, a little, some pizzazz or something, because those few pictures with the Luau tribe, and I was like, wow, they look really gay. But I just thought that was interesting, man, to include. But that's your E1B1B, your ham bloodline, man. That's your EM35, and that is the tribe that President Barack Obama is descended from. So I just thought that was real interesting to kind of add to the presentation. All right, moving right along. And I know I actually covered this in the last presentation, but I'm going to kind of go over it again real quick because it's relevant to establishing Shem and Ham's bloodline. Now, obviously this is the E1B1A or the Negro or the Hebrew Y DNA right here that we're looking at. And we covered this before, but this is Shem's bloodline, man. These are your Hebrews, E1B1A, and the tribes that they're scattered into in West Africa. Now I'm going to kill two birds with one stone on this slide. So not only am I showing the Negroes and the E1B1A, or establishing Shem's bloodline, proving it, that we are not of the Hamitic bloodline. But if you go down a little bit here, it says this E1B1A, or the smaller nomenclature is also called EV38 or EM2, reaches frequencies of over 80% in many parts of West Africa, Central Africa, East Africa, as well as Southern Africa. But it says this haplogroup's frequency and diversity are highest in West Africa region. Of course, we already know that. Within Africa, EV38 displays a west to east as well as south to north cineal distribution. In other words, the frequency of the haplogroup E1B1A decreases as one moves from Western and Southern Africa toward the eastern and northern parts of the continent. Let me say that one more time. In other words, the frequency of haplogroup E1B1A decreases as one moves from Western and Southern Africa toward the eastern and northern parts of the continent. So that kills their argument that the E1B1A originated in East or Northern Africa, because in fact our DNA trails off when it gets to those regions. So we don't even have to say no more on that, man. I mean, I'm just destroying these lies, and doing it by genetics and science. How cool is that? The Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary tells us that Ham became the progenitor of the dark races. All right, and then it went on to name the dark races that he became progenitor of: the Egyptians, Africans, Canaanites, and Ethiopians, but not the Negroes. And if the Negroes, who are also known as African Americans here in America, are not of Ham, that would mean they are of Shem. Does science and DNA support this revelation? Yes, I'm proving that it does. By Y DNA evidence and genealogy, it is clear that Negroes and or so-called African Americans are not from the Hamitic bloodline of those groups listed in the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary, which clearly shows they are not from the bloodline of Ham. And here's more genetic proof before I conclude this segment. So, okay, what we're looking at here on this slide is I have them side by side. I've already genetically established that the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary lists the groups that are the bloodline of Ham, and they are the Ethiopians, the Egyptians, the Libyans, and the Africans or Canaanites. And I established that those groups are actually E1B1B or EM35, which establishes firmly that that Y DNA haplotype is the bloodline of Ham. Now, the E1B1A or the EM2 or the EV38, that's Shem's bloodline. Those are the Negroes. I have them listed to the left. And you see there some of the groups and the tribes that we're mixed into. Now, keep in mind, this list is nowhere near the comprehensive of all the different groups that have a percentage of Hebrews or Hebrew blood. Okay? But these pretty much are the highest ones, or the highest percentages, or whatever the case may be. All right? So this concludes my thesis on whether or not blacks or so-called Negroes are from the bloodline of Ham. I've proven genetically and conclusively that Negroes are not of Ham and do not share the Y DNA of the Hamitic groups belonging to that bloodline. And we're going to keep this real simple, because I'm not ever trying to be the author of confusion. So I want all to understand. Shem's bloodline is Y DNA haplotype E1B1A. Ham's bloodline is Y DNA haplotype E1B1B. It's as simple as that. The powers that be and the so-called geneticists, they got it twisted. You know, they really have it twisted. E1B1B is actually the sub-Saharan haplotype, and they're attaching themselves to E1B1B, so they're basically jumping from Japhet to Ham, which I find is hilarious. You know, the Ashkenazis and all those guys and those groups, you know, they're really quick to kind of attach themselves to E1B1B in some way, calling it Jewish. Which, let me say this real quick, there is no way you can actually test for a quote unquote Jewish gene. That's just kind of crazy. You know, Judaism is a religion. You can't, there's no such thing as a Jewish gene. How do you test for Jewishness? I mean, either you're from Israel and you're an Israelite by blood, lineage, and genealogy, or you're not. Simple as that. So I just kind of wanted to say that real quick. But anyway, not to go off on a tangent, Shem's bloodline is E1B1A, contrary to a lot of the false information that's out there. And Ham's bloodline is E1B1B. And it says not the Negroes. I've proven conclusively and emphatically that Negroes are not of the bloodline of Ham. The DNA evidence submitted on the groups, the Ethiopians, Libyans, Egyptians, and Africans, who Ham became the progenitor of, all possess the E1B1B Y DNA haplotype. All right, when it said not the Negroes, well, Negroes possess the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype, proving genetically and conclusively, once again, Negroes are not from the bloodline of Ham. This concludes this segment. On to the next. Okay, now I wanted to give a visual, because I'm real big on visuals. You know, when I made the statement that the E1B1AY DNA haplotype is the founding lineage of Israel, is because that's the only logical conclusion to draw once you really look at the genetic and scientific evidence. And again, the African Limba, they're the prototype with this, because basically when they let the cat out of the bag with the African Limba and let it out and put it out that they were actually Kohens or Kohen Modo haplotype, they tested positive and had the highest concentration of it than any group on the planet, they couldn't unring that bell, man. They basically opened the floodgates for all of us, essentially, because my suspicions were confirmed. Like I said, they tried to tell us that the African Limba were in haplogroup J, which is a European haplogroup, but I disproved that, and that's a lie. That's a blatant lie, right? So they are the prototype, because again, my suspicions were confirmed. They're actually E1B1A, man. So, and I knew it all along, and it was just confirmed. So they are EM2 or E1B1A, just like we are. So they're the prototype. And you look at the African Limba, you look at their features, they don't look like dark-skinned Middle Easterners or dark-skinned Arabs, do they? No, they don't. They look like Negroes. They look like black people, all right? So pause that. So to draw the logical and scientific conclusion that the E1B1A is a Negro haplogroup that belonged to the founding fathers of Israel was the only logical conclusion to come to. And that was that the African Limba was actually like the kind of the missing piece that we needed to kind of put this whole thing together. At least for me, that did it for that. That was like the linchpin I needed, man. That it really did. Not, you know, I give all praise and due to the Most High for that. So they are the prototype. And so now that we know and have genetic proof that they are from the tribe of Levi, right? Well, listen, Levi and Judah had the same mother and father, right? They were both Negro. So Levi and Judah are going to look alike. They're not going to be, you know, look totally separate from each other. They're going to be two black young men that look like their father, Jacob. So, with that said, that's going to segue into the next segment of the 12 tribes of Israel are Negroes. But let's first take scripture and deal with the color of the original Hebrew Israelites. I decided to do this segment because, you know, I'm pretty sure. Now, this obviously isn't for other Hebrews, but I'm pretty sure there's a lot of brothers and sisters out there and a lot of people who, you know, started hearing all this stuff about Negroes or Shem and this and that, and Hebrews are black and Negroes. And they're like, you know, where's all this stuff coming from? Well, I think it's important to kind of, you know, to get it established from scripture, from the Bible. So I decided to do this segment right here and come to a scientific, genetic, and logic conclusion at the end of it, that in fact, the original Hebrew Israelites, as put forth by scripture and by genetics and DNA, were black or Negro people. All right, they're very dark skinned. So we're going to start with Lamentations. Get your Bibles out, King James Version. An older one now, because in terms of the Israelite skin color, they've taken the word black out of the newer King James versions of the Bible. Yeah, there's no end, man, to what they'll try to do, man, to keep the truth hidden. But anyway, moving right along. Lamentations 4:8 says, their visage is blacker than a coal. They are not known in the streets. Their skin cleaveth to their bones. It is withered. It has become like a stick. And visage is defined as a person's face. It's as clear as day. Right there. Lamentations 4:8. On to the next scripture describing the skin color of the original Hebrew Israelites as being black. And remember, when we get to the end of the segment, I will tie it all together and end with that conclusion. Jeremiah 8:21, it says, for the hurt of the daughter of my people am I hurt. I am black. Astonishment hath taken hold on me. All right. It's clear as day. I am black. On to the next scripture. All right. Jeremiah 14:2 is actually dealing with the Israelites as a people, because it uses the collective word they, and it says, Judah mourneth, and the gates thereof languish. They are black unto the ground, and the cry of Jerusalem is gone up. So again, they reference the word black in relation to all of the Hebrew Israelites of ancient Israel. Job 30:30 says, my skin is black upon me, and my bones are burned with heat. For some reason, this is one of the more popular scriptures describing the skin color of the Hebrew Israelites. Song of Solomon says, I am black but comely, O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. You know, I always chuckle with the Song of Solomon 1:6, because in the very in the previous scripture, he said that I am black. And then it's like, for good measure, he wants you to know and make sure that you know that he's black. In the Song of Solomon 1:6, he says, look not upon me because I am black, because the sun hath looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyards, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. So I really think this is the Most High working here, you know, letting us know that, hey, don't fall for it. You're going to go through all these things, whatever. They're going to try to keep your identity hidden and who you were and all this. But I think all of this was from the Most High, man, letting us know that, hey, you were a black people. You were Negroes. And everything is kind of tying together, man. So let me go ahead and end this segment and come to my conclusion. Then we go on to the next segment. And finally, I submit in relation to the original Hebrew Israelites being black people, this piece right here. Now, George Friedman, in his book The End of the Jewish People, pointedly states that the Europeans claiming to be Jews are nothing more than quote unquote Hebrew speaking Gentiles. Wow. Now this, get this. The late president of Egypt, Gamal Abdel Nasser, stated on television, quote, "You, the Jews, will never be able to live here in peace because you left here black but came back white. We cannot accept you." Now that right there, my people, is the exclamation point. Okay, everyone is not in the everyone is not trying to be about keeping the truth hidden. All right, there's people that know the truth, and this president, this late president of Egypt, he says straight up, "You left here black but came back white." Man, I mean, that speaks for itself. Okay, and again, to those who say or try to say that the original Hebrew Israelites, you know, were dark-skinned Middle Easterners, no, pause that. Look at this picture of the African Lemba, who are from the tribe of Levi. Now you tell me, do they look like dark-skinned Middle Easterners to you? Do they look like dark-skinned Arabs? No, they don't. And remember, the African Lemba, they're our prototype to all my Hebrew brothers and sisters out there. Okay, they've already tested for the Cohen Modal haplotype. All right, they're the tribe of Levi. All right, the priestly tribe of Aaron. Okay, they let that cat out the bag for us. Thank you, geneticists over in UK, whoever did that. We appreciate you, you know. But in all seriousness, with that said, given all the information that I presented, given all the scriptures as it relates to the color of the original Hebrew Israelites as being black people, the fact that the African Lemba are the descendants of the tribe of Levi and they are clearly a black Negro people, it only leads to one logical conclusion, and it's that the original Hebrew Israelites, I conclude, were a Negro dark-skinned people, not dark-skinned Middle Easterners, but black Negro people. And remember, Levi and Judah had the same mother and father. Leah was their mother. All right, so Levi and Judah are going to look a lot alike. All right, just to kind of add to that. So before we kind of end this segment, I think I've proven conclusively and genetically that the original Hebrew Israelites were definitely a black Negro people, not dark-skinned, you know, Middle Eastern looking or Muslim looking or all these crazy things I've heard out there. No, they were a black Negro people. I want to add this as a sort of like addendum. I want to add the, so I don't have to do a whole different segment. I want to add the Y DNA evidence of the African Lemba, and as well as the Bantu, in comparison with each other. Okay, I think that would be very it would definitely add to the presentation, and like I said, I won't have to do a separate one for that. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and end this right here and get ready to bring forth the Y DNA evidence of the Bantus and the African Lemba. All right, now we're moving into the addendum I was telling you about with the Y DNA of the Bantus and the African Lemba, you know. And as I'm sitting here kind of, you know, reviewing this DNA evidence, it's just kind of fascinating, in that, you know, the lengths that people will go through and go to perpetuate a lie. I mean, just to kind of keep, you know, our identity hidden, to keep the truth hidden. I mean, it's just, I don't know, man, it's mind-boggling. It reminds me of something my grandmother would always say. She said, if you tell one lie, you'd have to tell so many others to cover up for the first lie. And that's very true. You know, not to go on a tangent, but I just kind of had that thought and I wanted to, you know, just kind of speak on that real quick. But all right, here we go with the addendum of the Y-DNA evidence of the Bantu. And as it turns out, they were actually a key part in this whole thing and we never knew it. You know, I always heard racists and these so-called smart-ass whites saying, oh, the black people, you black people are from Bantu expansion and that. But they were saying it in a way that was supposed to be degrading, or it was supposed to be like, you know, Bantus were African and, you know, sub-Saharan and all this kind of stuff. Not even realizing that the Bantus were actually Hebrew Israelites, and they actually held the key to us unlocking who we were. And we never knew it, right? So here it goes. Now here's the abstract on that DNA evidence. It says technological and cultural innovations, as well as climate changes, are thought to have influenced the diffusion of major language phyla in sub-Saharan Africa. The most widespread and the richest in diversity is the Niger-Congo phylum, or phylum, thought to have originated in West Africa 10,000 years ago. Now, the expansion of Bantu languages, a family within the Niger-Congo phylum, 5,000, represents a major event in the past demography of the continent. Many previous studies on Y chromosomal variation in Africa associated with Bantu expansion with haplogroup E1B1A, and sometimes its subgroup or sublineage E1B1A7. However, the distribution of these two lineages extends far beyond the area occupied nowadays by Bantu-speaking people, raising questions on the actual genetic structure behind this expansion. All right, now, so basically what that's saying is that the Bantu expansion, when the Bantu expansion happened, that migration, it was almost like they're saying, it was a whole new wave of people that came from somewhere, in a sense, right? Because it's like, and you'll see in the next slide or whatever, that the Bantus are E1B1A, which we know now is Shem's bloodline. And you'll see as we move forward that no other tribe or no other in Africa pretty much has our DNA, which further gives off the impression or gives off the factual assumption that we are exclusive, all right, to the area, and we're mostly saturated in West Africa because that's not where we originated. Okay, so with that said, we're going to move on to the next slide. All right, you know, in the spirit of saving time, because we still got a little, you know, a good ways to go with this presentation, but I'm very happy with where it is and you know where it's headed. I've covered a lot of information already. So with that said, I'll just start to kind of cover the highlights. All right, now here it says among the five populations, the homogeneity of the Bantu is striking. Now here again, they are marveling at our DNA and how different it is from all the other surrounding areas, all the surrounding groups. All right. Now let's go down here. It says the Bantu modal haplotype was not significantly associated with any single tribal group. Now let's say that one more time. The Bantu modal haplotype was not significantly associated with any single tribal group. Furthermore, no particular association of tribe and haplotype was immediately apparent. So again, what that's saying, that's verifying what my position has been from day one. Our DNA is exclusive to Africa, Western, Eastern, Northern, and Southern, because our DNA did not start there. That's why they're marveling at our DNA, talking about it striking and all this and that, because it's so different from all the other tribes and all the other so-called African groups in that area, because we are not from the same bloodline. That's all that's saying. That is all that is saying, that we, the E1B1A in the area, is so different because we're not from the same bloodline. And that's all it's saying. So, and they're like, wow, they're like, this is so amazing, you know, but we already know why it's different from all the other bloodlines, because we're not the same people. On to the next slide. We are Hebrew Israelites. But we still have to be careful with a lot of these so-called geneticists and these scientists around the world, man. All right, now this slide is it actually establishes the Bantu and Limba Y chromosomal connection, which is a great thing, because like I said, my suspicions was always, my suspicions were confirmed about the African Limba. The thing I don't like about this the slide or information on this slide is that it's still holding on to the fact that they're trying to say that the Cohen modal haplotype, this Ashkenazis and these Sephardic Jews, have this so-called Cohen modal. I'm sorry, man. I'm not buying that. I'm not buying it, because to say that Ashkenazis have the Cohen modal haplotype, that's essentially saying that they are from the tribe of Levi, man. And we know that is total, that's bogus. I think what they're doing is they're injecting themselves into our history. They're not going to let us have the whole light. They're injecting themselves into our history. They're saying, okay, you got us. We give the Limba the Cohen modal, but they're still pushing this whole Ashkenazi Sephardic Jew thing, man. Cohen, listen, they are not Cohens, man. I'm not buying that. That's why black people, we really need our own geneticists. We need our own scientists to conduct our own DNA tests. We really do. I mean, what I'm doing, my work and my assignment is important, but I'm not a geneticist. You know, I wouldn't know how to separate STR markers from, I'm not a geneticist. I'm just a brother who's enlightened, who's intelligent, and I have enough knowledge about DNA to give what I'm giving you. But we need more black Hebrew geneticists, man, to conduct our own experiments and not totally trust the science of whoever else, because I think they're mixing up the truth with some falsehood. That's what I really feel in my spirit. I really feel, I'm just not buying that Ashkenazis have no Cohen modal. I'm sorry, I'm not buying that, man. But let's scroll down. I don't want to go on a tangent, right? It says two striking features are the large proportion of haplotypes found in the Bantu that are also present in the Limba, and the even higher proportion of Y chromosomes. So again, they're establishing that Bantu Limba connection. We are from the same bloodline. All right, so we're going to end on that and go to the next slide. I just give all praise and honor, to the Most High, especially for, granting me with a healthy dose of the spirit of discernment. Because there's just a lot of stuff out here, man, that's truly, disheartening. But when you have the spirit of discernment, you can see through and see past a lot of the BS, So we're moving on, man. This particular slide right here, I actually decided to use this. But I want to shout out the brother that decided to send this to me. So on the bit shalom to brother Yaqub Ben Yisrael for sending this to me. It's a lot less confusing, and it shows the EM2 or the E1B1A, for our Limba brothers. And, I thought that would be really, really cool to actually, see that we are definitely from the same seed and bloodline. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and conclude this addendum, and we're moving on to the next segment, which is the 12 tribes of Israel are Negro. All right, so here we are, the next segment. And as many of you already know, I'm very visual. I like to provide visuals to my presentation. So, I think it's you get more from a visual, actually seeing vice just hearing words, and talking about something. Now, this is a very, this whole presentation is important. But I really want to touch on a lot of things with the whole 12 tribes. I'm going to keep this and make this as basic genetics 101 as I can, especially considering, I've already done the 12 tribe chart, genetic breakdown. So please continue to share that video. And, cause there's still a whole lot of people out there who, who just have no clue and don't know the truth about, the 12 tribes and everything like that. So, There's really no need to try to incorporate a whole bunch of or groups of people who are simply not Israel. They're not Hebrew Israelites, that they do not belong. And I've already covered this. I've covered this in the abstract. If you are not of the Negro E1B1A or any of its subgroups, you are not a Hebrew Israelite. And it's as simple as that. I've already logically and scientifically and genetically made the logical conclusion based on all the evidence that I've submitted so far that the E1B1A is the founding lineage for the ancient Israelite nation, meaning Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob possessed this E1B1A. So yes, this is the bloodline of Shem, contrary to all the information that's out there saying the exact opposite, okay? And I've already proven that. No one can dispute that. So with that said, let's get into it. Let's deal with this. We'll bring this out because there's still a lot of stuff out there. It's just not quite right or whatever. So, all right. Now we're going to keep this simple. Okay. Jacob was a black man. He was a Negro. All right. I've already established that. So I don't have to beat that about your head or whatever. Jacob was a Negro. Okay. He possessed the E1B1AY DNA haplotype that he passed on to all 12 of his Negro sons. Now, to hammer that point home, the four women that had his children were Leah, as you can see, Bilhah, Zilpah, and Rachel. All four of them were Hebrew Negro women. So a Negro man and a Negro woman is not going to have a Negro child in a Mexican or a Negro child and an Aborigine. I mean, come on, man. We need to get rid of all that. That's a bunch of foolishness. All those groups or those people, listen, stop it. Okay? Stop it. The 12 tribes of Israel are Negro. Bottom line. Okay? The 12 tribes of Israel today represent the E1B1A and all of its subgroups. That's Negroes and their seeds worldwide. Okay? So, with that said, it's simple. Like, for example, and I think I kind of touched on this a couple slides back, but Levi and Judah, matter of fact, Reuben, Levi, Judah, and Issachar were all born of Leah. So that means they have the same mother and father, okay? So there's no way that a group of Indians are gonna be from Reuben and a group of Mexicans are gonna be from Issachar, and then you got Levi and Judah, you know, they're supposed to be Negroes. And come on, man, that's just foolishness. Okay, let's kill all that 12 tribe stuff. That's foolishness, and genetics will never support that. Okay, let's stop that. Let's kill that, man. That's just foolishness. Okay, they have the same mother and father. Okay, Leah didn't birth a Mexican. She didn't birth an Indian. She birthed 6 black children for Jacob. That's what she birthed. 6 Negro males. And let's just keep it 100. Let's keep it all the way funky, man. She birthed 6 young black babies for Yaqub. Okay, and that's just that. It's as simple as that. All right, so we can just you know, kill all that. And I think I've presented enough genetic evidence about the not only the complexion but the race of the original Hebrew Israelites. So I don't want to beat this about your head ad nauseum. I really don't. But I think it's important to address this because, you know, there's, like I said, there's still a lot of misinformation out there, and these guys running around, you know, talking about this 12 tribe chart stuff. And it's just ridiculous. You know, you got, brothers out there got Aborigines thinking that they're Israel, man. I mean, come on with the foolishness, man. This is just foolishness. Stop it. Please stop it. All right. I mean, even if your intentions are pure. Okay, you have no right, you have no authority, you know, making people Israel or children of Israel that are not. It's as simple as genealogy, man. You have the bloodline or you don't. If you are not, the Negro is the key to Israel, period. If you do not have the Negro haplotype of E1B1A or any of its subgroups, you are not a Hebrew Israelite. Okay, and I'm moving on from that. But with all that said, and I want all of you to understand this, you need to get off this sort of racial or racist ideology about the 12 tribes of Israel and the descendants of the 12 tribes and all this race mixing stuff and all this. That's a bunch of foolishness. Okay, the 12 tribe or the descendants of the 12 tribes today. Yes, it's going to be Negro, but it's going to be all colors of Negroes. You have to understand that. Okay, the Hebrews have laid seed with all different races since we were scattered all over the world. That's just the harsh reality, okay? But if a black man, rather he looks like Tiger Woods or Blake Griffin, okay? If he has the E1B1A Y DNA haplotype or any of his subgroups, that man is a Hebrew Israelite. I don't care if he looks like a black Chinaman or a black Filipino, whatever it is. It's all about DNA. It's all about that genealogy, okay? The fact is, the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel walking around today are all different shades of black people. Not black people and Indians, black people and Aborigines and all this different kind of stuff. Yes, the Puerto Ricans, the Dominicans, the Cubans, yes, they all have a percentage of Hebrew Israelites. Not all of them, but they do have percentages of Hebrew Israelites within their group. So let's kill all this whole racial, racist thing. The 12 tribes, the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel walking around in the earth today are very mixed looking in terms of different shades of black. But make no mistake, it still boils down to the Negro, that E1B1A bloodline of Shem. So with that said, I'm going to run off a whole bunch of pictures and slides of what the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel look like today. And there you have it, my people. That is what the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel look like walking around the earth today. Very diverse looking mixture of black people. Bottom line. All right. Moving on to the next segment. All right. Here is an addendum that I forgot to add on President Obama's Y DNA haplotype of EM35 or the E1B1B. And it clearly states, his father is from the Luo Nilotic from East Africa, Kenya. And it says that Nilotic people have been investigated in studies of both autosomal DNA and Y DNA and carry predominantly haplogroup E1B1B. Okay. And it goes on to tell you some of the groups that they've tested and got samples from the populations. The Maasai, as a matter of fact, if you remember, the Maasai is one of the Hamite or the Hamitic Canaanite bloodlines that I showed the DNA for. And when I proved that the E1B1B was actually a Hamitic bloodline. So I forgot to add this addendum, but I thought it was very interesting to kind of see Barak and his Hamitic people. You know, he's from the bloodline of Ham, and he, like I said, he has no genetic ties to us, man. He is one of them. He's not one of us, which is kind of, I don't know, it's kind of weird, but it is what it is, right? Okay, moving right along. Now, some of you may know who this brother is. This is Luol Deng. He played for many years with the Chicago Bulls. But now he plays with the Miami Heat. You know, pretty good basketball player too. Luol, he's a Hamite. And it's a trip because I actually knew that before I kind of, researched him and found out that, he's actually a Hamite. And I don't know, something about that Ham bloodline. I just can tell someone from the bloodline of Ham. I don't know if that's a gift or what, but anyway, yeah, he it says Deng was born in West Sudan, now South Sudan, a member of the Dinka ethnic group. And I don't know if you remember, but I actually showed some DNA data on the Dinka, and we have, zero genetic ties with that group. It's so clear, man. I mean, the people that we are not a part of in terms of bloodline, but you cannot tell more than half the world that. They're just lost in the sauce, man. They look at us and they just kind of want to lump everyone together because, oh, you're all black, Africa, African people, all this kind of stuff. But nah, it's not that simple, man. And, we're not all the same people. Not to go on a tangent, but yeah, the brother right there, Luol Deng, he's a Hamitic brother. And, he's doing his thing in the NBA. So, shout out to Luol Deng. Okay, I'm going to go into what happened to the E1B1A in this segment. But the simple answer is there were a couple things that happened as to why DNA test does not show that the E1B1A is from Israel, and it would kill all this nonsense that goes on. But the simple answer is this. There were a couple things. Number one, there was a mass exodus and a mass migration of the Y DNA haplotype of E1B1A, bottom line. Okay, and I'm going to show you exactly what happened and how it happened, okay, in this segment. But that's the simple answer. And ironically, the same reason why all these European haplogroups show up and trying to say that they're Israel and they're Middle Eastern and they're Semitic and all this kind of stuff. For the same reason that DNA tests show that they are Semitic and they are so-called Middle Eastern, it's the same reason why our DNA is showing that we're so-called West African, because when we migrated, when we all left out, they all came in, man. And that's it. Like, let's frame that, pause that. That's the very generic answer as to why DNA test does not show that we are Hebrew Israelites and we are from Israel. That is exactly why. When we moved out, all these other rebel groups and invader groups moved in. And that's what you have today in terms of DNA tests. They're getting data from rapists, man. They're getting data from the people that stole our land. They're getting data from the people that murdered us and killed us, murdered our women. I'm going to go into all that right now. Let's get to it, man. This is like the meat right here. What happened to the E1B1A out of Israel? Let's get it. This is where it all started for our people. Galatians 4:26 says, but Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. So not only were we in our land, but we were in the actual motherland. And there we were, you know, we enjoyed the protection of the Most High. We lived, we thrived. We were his people. You know, at one point we did keep his law, statutes, and commandments. Because, you know, he said that he made the, in first person said that in Deuteronomy 7:6, for thou art holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. But see, with that, you know, we have responsibility. And he said, now therefore, if ye will not obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, ye shall be in a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. But again, that was the deal. Yes, he said he chose us above all nations, but we were to keep his law, statutes, and commandments, right? That is as simple as that. Now, I'm not saying that or going over this in a, you know, racial superiority kind of thing, whatever like that. This is just, the fact. This is our history. This is what it is. This is what they've been keeping hidden from us, the truth of who you really are. Okay, we are Hebrew Israelites, and that's the whole purpose of this presentation, to go into what happened. Now, I don't want to turn this into a movie per se, right? But the reality is, our history is very rich and very diverse. And like I told you before, I'm dealing with it. I'm going to bring it forth. Now, in the spirit of saving time, I'm going to kind of go over different things and touch on the things that are most important to the presentation in terms of, you know, what happened to us and everything like that. But keep in mind, you can always go and do your own research and your own reading and studying by getting a King James Bible and know that it's not a religious book. It's a history book, and it's about you. So knowing that, it gives you a different mindset going into it, reading it from in the beginning. All right, it's a history book and a very very direct history book as well, and it tells you what happened to us and where we fell short at and where we fell out of graces and disfellowship with the Most High. Okay, for all intents purposes, you know, we were in, you know, heaven on earth, man. You know, we were his people, he was our God. And all we had to do, our end of the bargain, was to keep his laws, statutes, and commandments, right? You know, have no other gods before him, worship no other gods, you know, but him, whatever he admonished us to do. But along the line, somewhere along the line, you know, we fell out of his graces. You know, we would always question him. We started complaining. You know, he brought us out of the Egypt and bondage and everything. He did so much for us, and our people were really ungrateful. They were ungrateful. They were impatient. As a matter of fact, when Moses came down with the Ten Commandments, they were worshiping calves just that quick. I mean, it was just a trip, man. You know, and long story short. With everything that the Most High did for us, you know, we didn't show gratitude. We didn't show appreciation. We didn't show honor, respect, you know, for everything that he had done, man. And all you have to do is get your Bible and go through, starting with, you know, Genesis in the beginning, go through Exodus and everything that he did for us, you know, with the Moses parting of the Red Sea and, and all that. So, he got very, very angry with us as a people, to the point where he told Moses that he says, let me alone that I might destroy them and wipe them off the face of the earth and make an even better people in a better nation than they could ever be. And I'll start with you. And it was that serious. But Moses stood in the gap for us. And the Most High showed mercy. Right. So let's fast forward a little bit. At the end of the day, when we get to Deuteronomy, at that point, you know, the Most High said, listen, you know, if you continue to choose not to hearken unto my voice, to follow my laws, statutes, and commandments, this is what's going to happen to you and your seed. And at that point, when he gave the prophecy of the curses that Israel would be under, right? You have to remember all those curses were going to come to pass. Now I'm going to go into that into the next segment as far as the prophecies and the curses that apply to us and how it all ties in with the so-called African Americans and the Igbos and the slave ships and the transatlantic slave trade and all that. I'm going to get into that in the next segment. But before we get to that, I have to deal with this. What happened to us? Now, first and foremost, I have to let the Most High set it off, because Jesus prophesied that Jerusalem was going to be destroyed. Okay, and we're gonna deal with that right now and bring that forth. All right, here we go. So now remember when I said that the simple answer to what happened to us was that basically we RYDNAE1B1A left and all these other groups came in. Right. Okay. Well, frame that. Pause it and frame that. All right. This is the Most High in Leviticus 26 and 33. He says in first person, this is the Most High talking, and I will scatter you among the heathen and will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate and your cities waste. So in lay terms, the Most High is telling you exactly what was going to happen, that there was going to be not a soul left in the land of Israel, in Jerusalem. And how do I know that? Well, let's bring up desolate and see what desolate means. Desolate, of a place, deserted of people, and in a state of bleak and dismal emptiness. Go down a little bit as a verb, desolate, to make a place bleakly and depressingly empty or bare. And there it is there. Now, how was this accomplished? Remember I said there were several things as to how this was accomplished in terms of there was a mass exodus and a mass migration, if you will, of our people in the E1B1A out of Israel. Well, let's deal with the first incident that happened that partly achieved that. And that would be the Assyrian deportation of about 720-722 BC. Remember I touched on how King Shalmaneser, he replaced a lot of our people with those Ethiopians. We were deported. That's when the 10 tribes were deported out of Israel. All right. And what's not talked about also is when the Assyrians came in, they actually replaced Hebrew with Aramaic. Right. Because so when I did the knowledge, if you remember, when I did the knowledge on my people, the Yoruba Jews, who said, OK, they were from Morocco. And when they got to Yoruba and said, hey, we are B'nai Ephraim. And linguistically, they spoke some Aramaic and some Moroccan. And it threw me off at first. I'm like, well, why were they speaking? Why would they be speaking Aramaic? Wouldn't it be Hebrew? And so when I dug a little deeper and I found out, okay, the Assyrians replaced Hebrew with Aramaic. So then it definitely lined up and made sense that when they fled Morocco into Yoruba in West Africa, and they were speaking some Aramaic, that then it definitely lined up. So let's go back. The Assyrian deportation, that was the first major event. That put a big dent in our E1B1A and all of our subgroups out of Israel. Okay, they weren't lost. They were literally deported. When the immigration comes and deports the Mexican brothers and stuff back to Mexico or whatever. But the thing is, and this is my personal opinion. The Assyrians had no right come and deport nothing. Nobody asked them to come to Israel, But anyway, not to go on a tangent, that was the first major event, the Assyrian deportation. So let's go a little bit into that, read a little bit on that, and before we continue on with the segment. Yep, the Assyrian deportation. You know, for all intents and purposes, this was the original Trail of Tears, man. You know, and you know, as I move forward, you'll see this wasn't like this didn't happen in just a day or a couple days or a couple months or a year even. You know, this was a long process. You know, over 20 years. But see, this is what happened when the Most High withdrew His protection from us, man. All hell broke loose. It was open season on us, man. And I mean, and these savages came up in there, and it wasn't like we didn't fight back. Please don't get it twisted. You know, we wouldn't on no singing, holding hands and singing kumbaya. Nah, we had our soul. We was doing our thing. You know, we definitely fought back as hard as we could. Many of us, you know, perished and died. You know, so, you know, we fought, man. But that Assyrian deportation, that took a huge chunk out of our migration up out of our homeland, man. And if you know, and if you look at that picture, man, I mean, that's a sad picture. You know, you being deported from your homeland. Wait a minute, how you gonna deport somebody from their own land, man? Like where did they do that at, man? You know, but again, you know, to keep it in perspective, you know, the Most High, He told us, you know, we wanted to be stiff-necked and we wanted to complain and we didn't want to keep His laws, statutes, and commandments. And when He withdrew His protection, man, oh man, it was open season. And I'm going to be honest with you, it's been on ever since. It's been on ever since. So let's go on to the next slide and you talk about this Assyrian deportation slash captivity for a little bit before we move forward and talk about the next event that pretty much did us in and did away with the E1B1A out of Israel. All right, the Assyrian captivity of Israel, or I like to refer to it as the Assyrian deportation of Israel. It said the northern kingdom of Israel was conquered by the Neo-Assyrian monarchs Tiglath-Pileser III and Shalmaneser V. The later Assyrian ruler Sargon II and his son and successor Sennacherib were responsible for finishing the 20-year demise of Israel's northern 10-tribe kingdom, although they did not overtake the southern kingdom. Jerusalem was besieged, but not taken. The tribes exiled by Assyria later became known as the 10 Lost Tribes. But make no mistake, the process was definitely underway for the E1B1A becoming a not even a distinct memory of their own homeland of Israel. I mean, you know, trust me, I do understand and get it. And I know that we were totally responsible for where we are as a people and as a nation. You know, but for me, you know, all things, you know, considered, it's still pretty, you know, pretty sad and somber, you know, in my spirit, you know, knowing the history of my people, man, and how we were, you know, basically kicked off of our own land. And, you know, basically we were the original Native Americans, you know, you can get technical. And so, yeah, that's kind of sombering, man. You know, even as I, you know, I've researched this, and I'm going over it and I'm narrating and everything like that. I'm bringing the knowledge to all of you. It's still pretty sombering to know, you know, what we went through as a people. And I mean, throughout history and I mean, what we're still going through today. I mean, it's just, yeah, it's pretty sombering. But moving right along. Now this Assyrian cuneiform, now this is very important. There's a lot of key things in this. All right, the Assyrian cuneiform states that 27,290 captives were taken from Syria, the capital of the northern kingdom of Israel, by the hand of Sargon II. Now that is significant. Why is that significant? Because when that happened, what's not listed here is when those 27,000 captives were taken from Samaria, okay, the Ethiopians were brought in and replaced them there, okay? And me and my right-hand man, Tony Judah, was building on this a couple Sabbaths ago, right? When Christ met the lady at the well, you know, we built on that, and it was real tight, you know? But that's why they think that they're us, okay? They were placed there by King Shalmaneser, but they're not us. Okay, that's key right there. All right, and Christ told the lady as much, pretty much like, you don't even know who you are. You know, you're not this isn't your land. Like, you know, he was telling her, like, letting her know, like, no, you're mistaken. Like, this is not your land. This is not the land of your forefathers. Well, anyway, not to go on a tangent, but that's key. That's important. All right. And he says this Sargon records his first campaign, yada, yada, yada. He tells you right here in the first reign, the people of Samaria to the number of 27,000. So he actually tells you how many people were carried away. All right. And let's scroll down. He said, the description of the final defeat of the northern kingdom of Israel above appears to be a minor event in Sargon's legacy. He said, some historians attribute the ease of Israel's defeat to the previous two decades of invasions, defeats, and deportations. Man, we were tired of scrapping with these fools, man. This has been going on, and we were just fighting, and it says right here, like I said, it was a process. Over 20 years, man, of invasions, of them messing with us, fighting them, you know, defeats, you know, them rounding us up and getting us up out of there. I mean, it was just, the Most High said our foot would not have rest, man. And I tell you, like I said, it's been on ever since, man. I mean, it really has. It really has. That's key right there, because that tells you that we have been fighting with them, with these Assyrians for a long time. And not to get too far ahead, but Flavius Josephus, he accounts for, I mean, all of that. He has like literally a timeline of things that happened with our people in the destruction of Jerusalem and what happened with the Romans. And, you know, we'll get into that. I guess I won't get too far ahead, but that's key. That tells you right there, man, we were fighting with them for a long time. And I'm sure we were tired, man. You know, we're trying to take care of our women and our children, and, you know, fighting these guys off, man. And, you know, you're trying to, you know, enslave us or kill us or kill our women and children, whatever the case may be. And it was a very long process of going through that back and forth. Like, I can't even imagine what they were going through, man. Like really, I mean, like they weren't messing with anyone. If you look at history, and this is what gets me to my heart about our people, man, and this lets me know that we definitely really are different, you know, in our spirit. Because if you look throughout history, you will not find not one time where Hebrew Israelites invaded nobody. We didn't enslave nobody. We mind our own business, man. You understand? Even the Most High said, don't abhor a stranger. Because remember, you were a stranger in the land of Egypt. What does that mean? That means that as the chosen people, as his chosen elect, we have to have compassion, something that we were never shown. Think about that for a minute, my people. Compassion. In spite of everything that we had been through, the Most High admonished us to still show compassion and also not to ever oppress one another or enslave one another. You will not find anywhere in history where a Hebrew Israelite, where we invaded anyone, where we oppressed anyone. And all throughout history, man, ever since, you know, like I said, the Most High withdrew his protection, man, we was fighting for our lives, fighting for our freedom. I mean, it's been on ever since, man. Let me tell you something. Those curses are very real. The prophecies are very real. And I'm sorry I had to go off on a brief tangent, but I just had to speak on that, man. You know, you look at history, we've never invaded anyone. We've never oppressed anyone. Okay, that goes against our nature. That goes against what the Most High always admonished and expected from us as a people. Don't abhor that stranger. Because remember, you were a stranger in Egypt. Come on, man. Think about that. But here we are fighting off these Assyrians, fighting for our lives, fighting for our homeland. And as you can see, slowly but surely, man, it was slipping away. Slowly but surely, man, we were our Y DNA of E1B1A was walking out of history, literally, slowly but surely. This is what you're listening to right now. This is what I'm bringing forth. All right. So let me continue. Let me read on. Some estimates assume a captivity numbering in the hundreds of thousands. minus those who died in defense of the kingdom, and minus those who fled. That's key too. Those who fled voluntarily before and during the invasions. That's key, because a lot of us did flee. We fled into West Africa. I'll get more into that in the next segment when I deal with the Roman destruction. But lastly, however, it has also been suggested that the numbers of deported by the Syrians were rather limited, and the bulk of the population remained in situ. There is also evidence that significant numbers fled south to the kingdom of Judah. And that's key, because that would explain how some tribes from the north, or for example, why some from Ephraim actually got kind of caught up with Judah. And that's why we're kind of mixed up today, even in America. You know, you have some from the tribe of Judah, from the tribe of Ephraim, with the Ebos over there, and they're from Gad. So that would actually explain the mixture. So with some from the north fleeing south, that definitely is key. And I wanted to kind of speak on that real quick. It's a trip how everything just kind of lines up, man. You know, but everybody hang on in there. I've covered a lot. We're running up on the end part of the presentation. All right, now before I deal with the very last part of the Assyrian deportation, I want to refer back to, what the Most High said, in first person, because it's relevant, and it ties everything together. All right, Leviticus 26, 32 and 33, he says, "And I will bring the land," which is Israel, "into desolation." We already defined what desolation is. That means totally empty, devoid. "And your enemies, which dwell therein, shall be astonished at it. And I will scatter you among the heathen, and will draw out a sword after you. And your land shall be desolate, and your cities waste." All right. And the Most High says, "I am the Lord, and I change it not." And let me tell you, when he says something, that's exactly what he means, man. I can't even begin to tell you the amount of enemies that have come through Israel and tainted their blood with the Holy Land, to the point where you got DNA thinking that they're actually Semitic. It's crazy, man. It's crazy. But he said it, and he meant it. He said, I will bring the land into desolation, and your enemies which dwell therein shall be astonished at it. So on to the very last slide before we go and end it with the Roman destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. And as much research as I've done, all this still just kind of boggles my mind, man. It really does. All right, moving right along. This is the last slide. It talks about the return. Now it says, "Unlike the kingdom of Judah or Yehuda, which was able to return from its Babylonian captivity, the 10 tribes of the northern kingdom never had a foreign edict granting permission to return and rebuild their homeland. Many centuries later, rabbis of the restored kingdom of Judah were still debating the return of the lost 10 tribes. However, Assyria had been conquered by Babylon, and Babylon had been conquered by the Medo-Persians." It's insane, man. All this conquering and invading, and why don't everybody just stay on their own home country turf, man, and just leave everybody alone, And we're not even having this conversation. Our people, our E1, B1A is showing up in Israel. We're doing our thing, and, don't mind me. I'm just thinking out loud, man. But I kind of got a problem with that whole 10 lost, that lost 10 tribe thing. Tribes ain't lost, man. Like the brother said in the African Limba video, we are not lost. We are scattered. Yep, I agree. All right, moving right along to the next segment. The Roman destruction of Jerusalem, 70 AD, the event that ended it all. Okay, and once again, because it's important, the Most High had already put it out there. the total destruction of Israel, of Jerusalem. He said it was going to be desolate, okay, and the cities were going to be waste. All right, that was prophesied, and he said that in the first person, okay. And then Christ, the Messiah, he prophesied that Jerusalem would be totally destroyed. And as you can see, he says, and Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And that, my brothers and sisters, is him prophesying the total destruction, Roman destruction of Jerusalem, 70 AD. Again, the event that ended it all, and quite possibly the saddest day in the history of our people and the history of the E1B1A. Let's get it. Yeah, the Roman destruction of Jerusalem, 70 AD. When I say that, you know, this is quite possibly the saddest day in the history of our people, in the history of our YDNF E1B1A, that's definitely not an understatement. The Romans carried out, man, such destruction, cold, callous, no mercy. They killed women, children, the elderly, priests. It was so many bodies that the Romans killed. They didn't have places to put the bodies, man. It was that bad. It was that bad. It was total decimation. And I'm gonna, submit some slides. You know, we're gonna kind of talk about it more in depth, because there was a quote unquote Roman Judean by the name of Flavius Josephus, who wrote and gave a first hand account as to what he saw and what happened. As a matter of fact, he actually has a chronology of events when this took place, definitely check out the complete works of Flavius Josephus if you have not done so, all right, because like I said, he gives firsthand knowledge on what he saw and what happened, man. And it was I can't even put it into words how awful and how bad it was, man. I'm serious. I'm not even over exaggerating. They did us dirty. They did us really, really dirty. Those Romans, man, they really did. But this event in human history is what completely altered the trajectory and migration of our YDNA haplogroup of E1B1A, our blood lineage, and our nationality as Hebrew Israelites. See, we either fled to West Africa, we were, captured and sold, as slaves there. We were constantly fighting, running, fighting, trying to avoid capture, trying to avoid being enslaved, by Arabs who, they tried to, come in and swoop in at a bad time. And they were capitalists, man. And they knew that we were cursed, and they called us Yehudi. They knew that, man. They knew who we were, and they know who we are right now. So our DNA only picks up where we ended up, not where we originated in Israel. Because remember, I said this event, literally, it put an end to the Jewish state. And that's how they describe it. It literally put an end to the Jewish state. Now you might ask, well, so how does that exactly, show that, or how did it get rid of the E1B1A? Well, in simple terms, when it was all said and done, there was no one left, literally. There was not one soul left in Israel. Remember, the Most High said it. It was going to be desolate, right? think back, it was going to be desolate. And I'm like I said, I'm going to provide some, you know, some firsthand accounts from this Flavius Josephus, and, you know, we'll go through that. But I just want to kind of set it up. This is the event right here that everything culminated to. I'm serious, I can't put into words how bad it was, man. Seriously, I definitely highly recommend you all Googling either the destruction of Jerusalem or the siege of Israel, something like that, or even like the complete works of Flavius Josephus, you know, PDF or something. I have his works, you know, and I tell you, it's something else, man. I can't even put it into words, but this is what culminated in the our E1B1A not pointing to Israel any longer, because when it was all said and done, this Roman destruction, 70 AD, those who weren't enslaved were killed. I mean, there was literally not a soul left. And on that note, we're going to jump into you know, some of the slides and talk about it from a firsthand account of Flavius Josephus. But this is what took us over the edge, man. Yeah, so we're gonna go on to the next slide. Well, you know, before I bring up some of the slides from you know, Flavius Josephus and his firsthand account, I kind of wanted to touch on some things that took place, man, during this Roman destruction of Jerusalem. There were, I mean, mass crucifixions of Hebrew Israelites, man. Hebrew Israelites were literally burned alive. I mean, children, women, they barred none. I mean, it was almost like they were possessed. I mean, they literally, a lot of Hebrew Israelites, mostly women and things, they asked, they begged, they pleaded for mercy. And these Romans, man, they had none. You got to read that chronology, man, of what they did to our people, man. I'm serious. I want you all to read that. You know, I'm not going to get into it because you know, we're running up on the end of this presentation. I know I've covered a lot, but I wanted to speak on that. I wanted to tell you some of the atrocities of what they did, and that still doesn't really do it justice in terms of what they did to our people, man. So I'm gonna be totally real with you. So when the Romans finally got theirs, when the Roman Empire came to an end, I was happy as a mug. They got done dirty too by the barbarians. I'm not going to go on a tangent, but they got done dirty too, because they did our people dirty, man. You know, they really did. So I'm going to get off this little soapbox. I'm not going to go on a tangent, but I wanted to speak on some of the atrocities and what they did to our people, man. I want you all to Google that chronology of Flavius Josephus and destruction of Jerusalem. All right. And we can talk about it on the YouTube page or whatever, but please Google that. You know, we can talk about it. But I wanted to touch on some of the atrocities and you know, what they did to our people, man. It was inhumane, man. It was, I can't even speak to that, man. I mean, I guess they were Hitler before Hitler, what they did to us, man. It was, man. All right. Moving right along to the next slide. All right. Here's a, you know, I want to give like a brief bio on Flavius Josephus, you know, the one who gave the first-hand account of the Roman destruction of Jerusalem. And you know, you all can kind of, you know, press pause and read it, whatever the case may be. But like I said, I definitely highly recommend his book, The Complete Works of Flavius Josephus, because if you are serious about researching your history as a Hebrew Israelite, that book is definitely a must-have. And I highly recommend it to everyone. So get your hands on that, or, you know, download it, get the PDF. Matter of fact, the PDF is available, you know, for free. So, you know, you don't even have to worry about trying to order it off Amazon. You can just Google Complete Works of Flavius Josephus PDF, and it'll come right up. All right, The Wars of the Jews, or The History of the Destruction of Jerusalem, Book 7. This is actually an excerpt from the complete works of Flavius Josephus. And here, you know, it goes into, you know, how, you know, containing the interval of about 3 years, and from the taking of Jerusalem by Titus to the sedition at Cyrene, and how that an entire city of Jerusalem was demolished. And if you go down a little bit, here's where we get the firsthand account verification that there was no one left in Israel. It says, now as soon as the army had no more people to slay or to plunder, because there remained none to be the objects of their fury, for they would not have spared any had there remained any other work to be done. Let me say it again. Now, as soon as the army had no more people to slay or to plunder, because there remained none to be the objects of their fury, for they would not have spared any had there remained any other work to be done. And that hammers home the point I made about them showing no mercy and just complete and utter destruction and inhumane treatment of our people. So there it is there, firsthand account of why the E-1B-1A no longer points to Israel. All right, it picks up where we ended up, not where we originated, because after the Roman destruction of Jerusalem, as you all can see, and the Most High said it, it was desolate. There was not an E-1B-1A left. It's like it's almost like we were, in a sense, wiped out of history. Our DNA was wiped out of history, right? At least from the Middle East, from our homeland. You know, so it's easy to keep us, or just kind of keep us in West Africa, because truthfully, there's nothing that exists that says that they should do anything else. Half the people that in the powers that be, they know who we are anyway. They know who we are, right? You know, you have to remember, like, we are a small percentage. There's more of our people who don't know or have a clue as to who we are, vice the Hebrews that do. Look at these mega black churches, man, these mega churches. And I'm not gonna call any names, but just look at that. And you see how lost we are. And unfortunately, 2/3 of us are gonna die and have already died, not knowing, you know, the truth. So, you know, there it is there. I think I got one or two more slides, man, and we're moving on from this segment, man. And I think I definitely hit the point home, you know, as far as what happened to us. All right. So we're moving on. All right. Josephus claims that 1.1 million people were killed during the siege, of which a majority were Jewish, really, and that 97,000 were captured and enslaved. Then it goes on to say, quote, the slaughter within was even more dreadful than the spectacle from without. Men and women, old and young, insurgents and priests, those who fought and those who entreated mercy, were honed down in indiscriminate carnage. The number of the slain exceeded that of the slayers. The legionaries had to clamber over heaps of dead to carry on the work of extermination. My God. Wow, man. It says many fled to the areas around the Mediterranean. Titus reportedly refused to accept a wreath of victory, saying that the victory did not come through his own efforts, but that he had merely served as an instrument of God's wrath. You know what? On to the next slide. Okay, so it says the Roman legions quickly crushed the remaining Jewish resistance. So like I said before, you know, we fought and we fought hard and we fought, you know, valiantly, you know, but in the end, it just wasn't enough. You know, we were, you know, overwhelmed. It says part of the remaining Jews escaped through hidden underground tunnels. Ah, okay. While others made a final stand in the upper city. This defense held the Roman advance as they had to construct siege towers to assail the remaining Jews. The city was completely under Roman control by September 7th, and the Romans continued to pursue those who had fled the city. Wow, talking about adding insult to injury. And I want you all to Google the Google Masada. All right, Google that in relation to the Hebrew Israelites and the Roman destruction. All right. All right. That's going to conclude this segment in terms of, you know, I definitely have shown and proven, you know, what happened to the E1B1A and why it does not point to Israel like I said I would. And that concludes this segment. You know, I'm going to go into the prophecies and the curses a little bit, and we'll talk about the Igbo connection and the Igbo connection to the African Americans and all the other Hebrew Negro blood throughout the Caribbean and all over the world. And then we're going to kind of end it. That's going to be that. So, you know, moving right along. All right, now this segment I definitely wanted to add and touch on because it deals with who we are by way of scripture. Now that's one of the beautiful things I love about being me, is that I have the knowledge and the wisdom of the genetics and the science and all that, but at the end of the day it still goes back to scripture for me. So now, this isn't for my Hebrew brothers and sisters per se, but, you know, for those brothers and sisters who may have been watching my videos and, you know, still, you know, kind of putting all this stuff together, you know, I want to show you from the scriptural standpoint, you know, and I told you segments back that the Holy Bible is actually your history book. It's not a religious book, contrary to popular belief. It's a history book and it's about you. Okay, these curses in the book of Deuteronomy, they deal specifically with our people or the children of Israel. Okay, those people, when I'll go through it in this segment, and I'll try not to, you know, draw it out too long, but I want you all to understand that no other group, okay, on this planet fits these curses. Okay, now I've already proven everything I needed to prove genetically in terms of who we are. Okay, we are Hebrew Israelites. As far as I'm concerned, you know, the DNA is a cherry on top because I believed who we were just from scripture, just from these scriptures. I mean, truth be told. But I'm also a firm believer in that it's not about what you believe or what you believe you know. It's what you can prove, right? So with that said, I'm going to go through this section, the curses in the book of Deuteronomy, and show you how it identifies and is talking about us, all right, to the T. So we're going to start here with Deuteronomy 28 and 15, and it says, "But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee." Okay, Deuteronomy 28 and 68. This is a scripture that I consider the foundational basis for who we are in the with the curses in the book of Deuteronomy. And it says, "And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt," which is slavery, again, "with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee. Thou shalt see it no more again, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you or save you." Now, the only group of people that were sent into slavery on ships were so-called African Americans. And in that, there's no doubt, okay? Because as Hebrew Israelites, we wouldn't have needed a ship to get to actually, you know, to Egypt, actually. So Egypt is actually a another word for slavery. So the Most High said he was going to put us back into slavery. Okay, now, the West Africans that were sold to the Europeans into slavery came from Nigeria, okay? And those West Africans, quote unquote, that was on those ships coming into slavery via the transatlantic slave trade, guess what? They mostly were Igbos, okay? So let's put it together. So the Igbos are actually what we call African Americans now today in America. Right. So the E1B1A, that's why we share that, because most of us are descended from the Igbos. The Igbos are the ones that were on those ships that went into slavery and got sent all over the place in the transatlantic slave trade. So truth be told, the Igbo, that is the key in the Negro Hebrew blood that was sent off to Puerto Rico, to Brazil, to the West Indies. Right, so let's see, now you're clicking, the mind is clicking now, right? All right, so I'm tying all these things together, okay? That's why it says so-called African Americans are actually Igbos, or the descendants of Igbos. All right, let's move on, let's continue.
This is the story of the Igbo, 25 million strong, a people once under siege by their very own government.
Biafra declared its independence.
And a people once captured and shipped across the Atlantic by the hundreds of thousands. A people who helped build America, and a people whose descendants are now discovering their Igbo roots, raising questions of cultural identity for countless African Americans.
Many African Americans actually do not know that they have Igbo heritage. The chances of their being Igbo is much, much higher than their chances of coming from Ghana or from Western Nigeria.
If you're from the right county in Virginia, you'd probably have a 60% chance of having Igbo ancestry.
All right. Now, I included that little piece on the Igbo so you could visually tie in what I had just told you about the Igbo, African-American, and all the other Negro related groups throughout the world, pretty much, and how they're all connected to the Igbo. It all points back to the Igbo. So back to the curses of the book of Deuteronomy. All right, now in these next few curses, they're going to detail the life of a so-called slave here in America to the letter, starting with Deuteronomy 28 and 30. It says, "Thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lie with her. Thou shalt build a house, and thou shalt not dwell therein. Thou shalt plant a vineyard, and thou shalt not gather the grapes thereof." Betrothing a wife and another man lying with her, that is the so-called African or black slave and the slave master sleeping with his wife at will. And it was common knowledge that happened all the time, and happened quite a bit. All right, on to the next one. All right, Deuteronomy 28 and 41 says that thou shalt beget sons and daughters, but thou shalt not enjoy them, for they shall go into captivity. And it's also common knowledge that the children were always literally yanked from the arms of their slave mothers and fathers and sold into slavery. This was commonplace. And even in that movie Roots, man, it was real popular. when they sold off, even though, you know, Kizzy was grown, they sold her off against the wishes of her mother and father. So that went on a lot. And that definitely, you know, ties in with the African slave experience here in America. All right. And Deuteronomy 28:50 says, "A nation of fierce countenance which shall not regard the person of the old, nor shew favor to the young." I could probably do a whole presentation on this alone. I mean, we don't have to go way far back in history. Just look at the recent rash of slayings of unarmed young black men. And then, of course, you go to history. Look at Emmett Till. 14 years old, man. I mean, he was a child, and grown men beat and torture him, you know, for allegedly whistling at a white lady, right? 14 years old, he was a child. Look at George Stinney. He was 14 years old, the youngest person ever electrocuted, man. The state of South Carolina killed that young man, railroaded him for a crime he couldn't have committed, and he didn't commit it. And the old pervert white man who actually committed the crime and killed the two little girls, he admitted it on his deathbed, and they still have yet to you know, give that young man a pardon, you know, in his death. So, you know, I can go on and on with Deuteronomy 28 and 50 forever. I mean, just look at the news, man. I mean, you know, Trayvon Martin, you know, Michael Brown. I mean, it just goes on and on, the rash of young black men. I mean, this country really has barred none in terms of our black men, right? So, and I mean, it lines up perfectly with the curse of Deuteronomy. And that's why I try to tell people, we're as a people, we're up under these curses. This is why we are going through what we're going through. All right, on to the next slide. In Deuteronomy 28:48 says, "Therefore shall thou serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness and in want of all things. And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he hath destroyed thee." Man, you know what? I'm going to let the picture speak for itself on this scripture. Yoke of iron upon thy neck. And if that ain't so-called African American slavery in America, I don't know what is. But yeah, I'm going to let the pictures speak to the visuals with the yoke of iron around the neck, and that speaks for itself. You know, but to add real quick, now the slaves that were sent all over the place, now again, we all fall up under the same curse. So yes, I'm pretty sure there were other slaves in these different islands and Portugal and all this kind of stuff that experienced the yoke. So I don't want to make it seem like, you know, African Americans, you know, was the yoke was exclusively on our ancestors' necks, because we all, you know, fell up under the same curses, and we were all slaves. You know, the Igbos were sent all over the place. So I want to kind of clear that up. I'm not trying to say that, you know, so-called African Americans were the only ones that had a yoke of irons on the neck, because all of the rest of our people that were sent all over the place were slaves and probably had yokes of iron around their neck as well. So I just kind of wanted to, you know, clarify that. All right. All right, my people, so there it is there, the curses in the book of Deuteronomy. Now, I implore each and every one of you to, I mean, you can watch this video as many times as you need to, but, and that's fine, and share it, you know, with all your friends and everything, but I implore each and every one of you to get your Bibles out, you know, hit up Google, you know, do your own research, take what I've given you and run with it. Okay, I assume and I hope that someone will take, you know, the work that I'm doing and take it to an even higher level, you know, for our people and for the nation. You know, like I said, I'm not a geneticist, right? And I'll go into all that in the summation. But in terms of ending this segment with the book of Deuteronomy and the curses, my people, you have to understand, some of us will read those curses and still, you know, deny or not see, you know, what it's telling them right there in the, you know, in their face, you know, telling you who you are. I mean, that just that. And I didn't include every single. I just included the top ones or whatever. That explains our experience here, our ancestors' experience, slavery experience here in America. And I'm sure, like I said previously, a lot of our people that were sent all over the place, and you know, in slavery, experienced a lot of those things as well. And I can't forget our people in Nigeria with the whole Biafra massacre. And I mean, Google that. You understand? Google that. I mean, we lost. Man, I'm telling you, we've been up under these curses, and we are all from the same seed. So we've all been affected by the curses of the Book of Deuteronomy. Please don't get it twisted. If after you've read all those curses, look at this video, and you still don't understand or don't get it, then you just weren't meant to get it. You know, you were obviously destined to die as one of those ones who belongs in the two-thirds. All right, and that's all I can really say. But I'm not going to speak too long here. I just wanted to end this segment, and I definitely wanted to get some scripture in and talk about how it refers to us and identifies us as Hebrew Israelites. And like I said, it described our experience to the T, right? So, you know, with that said, unless I have some addendums that I might want to add, that really concludes this presentation. All right, I'm going to offer a summation, you know, tie everything all together. And that's going to be that. But I want to thank everyone for supporting me and sharing all my videos, and I appreciate all your comments and engage me in the Facebook community, and you know, the Hebrew Haplogroup Nation, man, we're rising. So let's get the truth out there, man. I appreciate each and every one of you, and I'm going to continue to bring you the absolute truth. All right, and on that note, I'm gonna go ahead and bid everyone shalom. And I'm going to end this entire presentation with a summation, and that'll totally end everything. But lastly, Psalm 83 and 4, that's one of my most favorite. It says, "They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance." And my people, I submit to each and every one of you, that's exactly what they've done. Because many of us, we have no idea who we really are. Even when faced with evidence, proof, we are so lost, man. It's ridiculous. But you know, all that I can say is I will continue to do my part to fight, man, to get the truth out, and try to awaken as many of my people as I can. That's all I can say. That's all I can do, and that's my prayer, and that's my hope. But you know, you have to have the spirit of discernment and be receiving, and know who's talking to you and who's talking to your spirit, man. I mean, because you know, we're messed up. You know, we have to come from, you know, Christianity. That's not who we are. And when I say we have to come from Christianity, that's not a knock against Christ, because Christ is the King of Israel. But the actual religion of Christianity is what's hurting my people. Because Christianity is teaching y'all to do everything that the Most High told us not to do. And I'm not going to go on a tangent, but we really have to really come from that, man. We are Hebrew Israelites. That's our nationality. Okay? It's not a religion. It's a way of life. That's our nationality. That's who we really are. We're not from Africa and all that. But again, I just want to kind of speak to that real quick. But I'm going to come with the summation, and I'm going to end this thing out. All right? Shalom, everyone. Before I embarked on this journey, you know, committing to extensive and sometimes exhaustive research for putting this historic and revelatory presentation together, the first of its kind, actually, I made a pledge to each of you that it would be extremely comprehensive and no stone would be left unturned. As such, I pledged that once the presentation was completed, regardless of length, I would leave no doubt as to who the Hebrew Israelites were and who the descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel are in the earth today. From my very first DNA teaching video to my personal DNA results video, which I highly recommend viewing to those who haven't done so already. My constant position has been that it's not simply about beliefs or even a belief system. It's not about what you think. See, anyone can say anything, but that doesn't make it true. And it certainly doesn't make it factual. So you could have been told a lie your entire life with respect to your history, who you are, who your biological parent or parents are, you know, your ancestors and place of origin, etc. But your DNA can and will reveal your genetic truth. DNA separates fact from fiction, and it takes the guesswork out. It can either verify long-held family oral traditions that have been passed down for many years, or totally refute it, as in the case of the Tennessee Melungeons, a mixed race of people who for many, many years claimed to be of some type of exotic Portuguese mixture in other races, but didn't identify with one per se. Well, DNA revealed the Melungeons' true origin. Their bloodline was the result of an African male, or what geneticists call sub-Saharan African, and a European woman. And just like that, all the exotic sensational rhetoric regarding their place of origin went right out of the window. But see, that's the power of DNA and genetics. And with that same power, I was able to establish the bloodline of Shem and the bloodline of Ham, both sons of Noah. For many years, Negroes were told that we were from the bloodline of Ham. But the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary directly refuted that when it said that Ham became the progenitor of the dark races to include Ethiopians, Egyptians, Canaanites, or Africans, and Libyans, but not the Negroes. And just like that, the floodgates toward genetic enlightenment were opened. If Negroes, who are a dark race, were not of Ham, then that would mean two things. One, that they were actually of Shem, and two, genetically, they would not have the same Y-DNA haplotype as those groups listed in the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary as Hamites. And sure enough, upon genetic and DNA research, I was able to establish the Y-DNA haplotype of those groups listed as Hamites in the Compact Bible Dictionary as E1B1B, and the Negroes, or so-called African Americans' Y-DNA haplotype as E1B1A, thereby proving conclusively and by genetics, after years being told and taught that Negroes and so-called African Americans were of Ham, that Negroes aren't from the bloodline of Ham after all. Scripturally and now genetically has been identified as being Hebrew Israelites from the bloodline of Shem. Simplistically speaking, people tend to forget that Ham and Shem were brothers, which would explain why we are what they call one subclade away from those Hamites, Negroes being E1B1A, and Hamites being E1B1B. Get it? See, hundreds of years of being lied to, and I destroyed it, just like that, using the power of DNA and genetics. And it cannot be disputed, and it cannot be refuted. There's nothing else to be said on that. So I'm moving right along. Now, DNA evidence is lacking to substantiate the claim that Ethiopians are descendants of King Solomon, by the way, of the Queen of Sheba. Majority of DNA evidence I found on them all point to them being Hamites and of the E1B1B lineage, as stated in the Zondervan Compact Bible Dictionary. They are Cushites from the bloodline of Ham, and converted to Judaism when they were placed in Samaria by then King Shalmaneser and have been claiming to be Israelites ever since. Genetically speaking, however, they are not Hebrew Israelites, never have been and never will be. They're essentially over there in Israel living a lie with those other Gentile Ashkenazi Jews who are from Magog and Gomer, i.e. the bloodline of Japhet. See, I speak with authority and much confidence because what I'm saying is backed not only by scripture, but by science. And I stand on this truth against anyone. You can espouse all the lies you want, but a person's DNA cannot be altered or changed in any way. It's as unique as no two people having the same exact fingerprints. I showed what happened to the E1B1A and why our DNA no longer points to our true homeland of Israel and why it picks up now almost exclusively as West African in origin. But I've also proven that we do not share the same DNA as any local Western, Eastern, Northern, or Southern African tribe. Why? Because we are not the same people, nor are we from the same bloodline, despite having similar physical characteristics. I addressed and disproved the lies that the E1B1A is an African haplogroup that originated in, they say, East or Northern Africa, by showing that our DNA actually trails off when it gets to those regions, which means our DNA is pretty much separate and exclusive from all those Hamitic African tribes. Additionally, I showed that the E1B1B groups are the ones that came out of East and Northern Africa, not the Negroes E1B1A. Clearly, they have us confused. I've shown and proven that the original Hebrew Israelites were dark-skinned Negroes, not dark-skinned, quote-unquote, Middle Eastern-looking, using the African Limba as prototypes to prove my thesis, because they've already tested positive for the Kohen Moto haplotype, and therefore are from the tribe of Levi, the priestly tribe of Aaron, and are clearly dark-skinned and Negro, as Levi obviously was a dark-skinned Negro, as well as the other 11 sons of Jacob. I tied scripture identifying Negroes as Hebrew Israelites in the Bible by the curses in the book of Deuteronomy and the Ebos, who are obviously Hebrew, being mostly on those ships going into slavery via the transatlantic slave trade, being shipped as slaves to North America, the West Indies, Brazil, Puerto Rico, Cuba, Dominican Republic, Portugal, and all throughout Central America and the Caribbean, etc. The E1B1AY DNA haplotype and all of its subgroups are the descendants of Hebrew Israelites. If you do not belong to either of those groups, you are not a Hebrew Israelite by blood lineage. Bottom line, I don't care what lies other people have been telling you and getting you to believe. And I don't care what group it is. All right? That information is false. I already dissected the 12 tribe chart genetically. All right? It's a simple matter of genetics. You have the Hebrew DNA of E1B1A or one of its subgroups, or you don't. I mean, really, it's as simple as that. This ain't Chinese math over here. And I still urge all of you so-called, Egyptologists, running around talking all this Egyptology stuff, to take a DNA test, man. Really, I mean, because you cats are annoying. Take the test, all right? And stop wasting your time and breath because you're fascinated, with this Egyptian culture. That culture is not yours, by birth or nationality, and definitely not by DNA. And if you think it is, take the test and get your Y DNA haplotype, post it, improve it. Or stop your madness, man. Just stop your noise, man. I'm not hearing none of you cats. All right? Again, if your Y DNA haplotype is E1B1A or either of its subgroups, you are from the bloodline of Shem and a Hebrew. Deal with it. I did exactly what I said I was going to do with this presentation. And I urge you all to continue sharing this historic and groundbreaking video while committing to getting this word out. I have to admit, since I stepped on the scene, the game has changed in a major way. And I give all praise and honor to the Most High for His grace and mercy and for the revelations. If any of you want to be sure of your Hebrew lineage, you have to take a DNA test. There's no way around it, unless you want to continue to believe blindly. And that's fine too, if that works for you. But they are brothers and sisters, and right here in America, they look like us, but are not from our bloodline. I mean, not a huge percentage, but they exist. This is why DNA testing is crucial to obtain that Y DNA haplotype and know for sure. I'm E1B1A7A. Hebrew Israelite all day, man. B'nai Ephraim. And on that note, I conclude this presentation. I thank you all for your continued support, and I bid you shalom.